Radio, welcome to a Sprawl and Brawl episode number 33. I believe that's right. Let's just say that's right. But it is January 5th, 2017, that's for sure. I am your host slash producer, Wild Matt, and Sliner is here as always.
Hello, as you intro me as I'm drinking, but hey.
Yeah, you're on my other screen. I don't look over there too often.
Yeah, that's cool.
I only see you when you're actually on the feed, so.
Yeah, my sexy face.
If you want to say that.
Some people do.
Mm-hmm. A particular Asian lady, maybe.
No, there's multiple Asian ladies. There are multiple Asian ladies.
Yeah, I guess. Not verified, though. I can't verify any of this information right now.
True.
On a later episode, maybe we'll discover that. But hey, megascorcher.com, talk about episodes. Go there if you want to check out all our other 33 episodes. We got so many. Well, I guess 32. Did we ever have an episode zero with this?
I'm sure we had some fail episodes that...
I forget. Well, I usually do a zero episode just for the fuck of it, because it's usually always the, hey, let's fuck around.
Yeah.
And then the next one after is like the real one.
Well, the thing is, we were doing this in Insidious, and then we created this because it was taking up too much of Insidious. So,
A couple people complained about it.
A couple? Yeah. Only a couple?
And they were like, well, I mean, a couple people on the show. In the crowd.
Okay, on the show, that would be a person.
No, two. There's two.
It was you, me, and May.
Yeah, and Curbs was also on that show at the beginning. He was there for a while. He was there longer than... Yeah, he was there for like 17 episodes or something.
Oh, I don't remember that. Was I there for those episodes, or did I come in to replace him?
No, you were definitely on the... We were all on the same episode for a little while.
Just like...
Right,
take it, like, just...
I know, that was so long ago. If I had to guess, it was probably 2013. If I had to guess... But I don't know. Yeah. It might have been 14.
I don't know. Yeah.
It was a long time ago.
I don't remember that. I do not remember.
We've already been doing this for, 7 months now? Maybe not Sprawl and Brawl, but Fresh Air.
No, yeah. Fresh Air. Yeah, we've been definitely doing it for, 7-8 months almost.
Yeah, we're getting there. And we only missed, a week of actual episodes. Like, I was alone for a few times.
Yeah. All right, I missed a couple of weeks.
And then Curb just disappeared because I got school.
Yeah,
I got school. Can't do other
things.
He did no
prep work for the show whatsoever. He can't show up for an hour and talk. But hey,
no, can't do that. Can't do that. He offered to do stuff from his studio at the school, but
that's not going to work well.
I know. I'm like, dude. We've been doing the show live since the start. Why the hell would I all of a sudden do pre-recorded stuff? I don't know if I've ever actually done pre-recorded stuff on the show. I don't think I've ever done that. I've recorded some stuff in advance for the show, but it wasn't me. It was like other footage of video games.
Because I remember you did some pack stuff and all that type of shit before. So, but again,
Oh yeah, like the floor stuff is. Yeah, but then we do it on the show and you talk over it.
But yeah,
I've never actually done.
I want to say like
prepared footage for the show.
We did for the Mario Tennis, or was it Mario Tennis, or was
it Mario doing that? Olympics. Doing that stuff is hard.
Yeah, I know.
Doing that stuff is hard.
Yeah, writing out a script and having people try to stick to it is...
Oh, no, not even writing... Oh, okay, sure. No, I'm talking about, going out on location and,
Oh, shoot, okay, yeah. They went to a freaking, track in the middle of fucking some place they're going to get shot or something.
Check this out. I guess I did record some reviews. I recorded some reviews.
Yeah.
And okay. Just play them, because sometimes reviews just take like 30 minutes, and it's just like, this will be faster if I just set it down to 10.
Especially
minutes.
If you were the only one that played the game, it really doesn't work.
All right, this is the MMA show.
It is.
Yeah, youtube.com/MegaScorcherTV. Go there.
Sprawl and Brawl.
It's episode number 33.
You make that a fight up. You make that a stand-up fight, motherfucker.
Mm-hmm. Well, unless you miss the brawl, then you gotta... There's gotta be... It should be Sprawl and Brawl and Scramble.
Mm-hmm.
You should have another step ready just in case. Can't just be doing two things here. That's an old term. That's a thing. It's from back in the day. Don't really use that term too much anymore.
What, scramble?
No, sprawling, brawling.
Oh, sprawling. Okay.
Yeah. Both those things. I guess a brawl, but you know, that's one thing.
Yeah.
It's only one thing. Anyways. And hey, iTunes, all that goodness, wherever you can find podcasts, we're there too. So let's start off with some news before we go off into anything else this week, including, hey, we got some end of the year MMA awards. So we'll be taking a look back at 2016 because, you know, it's 2017 now. Isn't that crazy?
It is. It is quite.
It's already January 5th, 10 days away from the next UFC.
Yeah.
That's how I look at time here.
BJ, motherfucker, BJ! Yeah. BJ's back!
Like January 5th, whatever. That doesn't mean anything to me. 10 days. That's the number. All right. So UFC is throwing Todd Grisham into a UFC broadcast position. He worked on WWF stuff back when it was maybe called WWF. He was probably there when it made a transition.
No, he can't be that old.
Yeah, yes. He's been there for a long time. Like the coach was there when it did all that stuff. So Todd Grisham might have been there. And Todd Grisham did that online show called Bite This, and that was a really long time ago too. So anyways, and then he did some boxing stuff. He did, what's that? Kickboxing Glory. Yep.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So he's been all over the place. He's been on ESPN.
Meaning he broadcasted for Glory.
He was like on the desk, like going like, hey, that was a good fight, right, guys? Yeah, it was a pretty good fight.
I thought the way you phrased that, it sounded like he was actually a fighter in Glory.
Oh, no. He broadcasted in Glory. Yeah. No, Todd Grisham's a very small guy.
Yeah. Well, I'm just, yeah. Well, you could have done lightweight or something like that.
Oh, yeah, sure. No, I'm nothing against him. He's just not very, he doesn't have the kickboxer body.
Well, Joe Rogan's a short guy, and he did, like...
I guess, but, like, see, Joe Rogan, though, he's stocky, but he's very big. Like, he's wide.
He was always
kind of wide, even as a kid. Like, look at his video where he fucking kicked that dude. And News Radio. News Radio, too. But even the video where he kicked that dude, he's pretty wide and lanky.
Yeah.
Who's that kid? He wasn't...
I saw some videos of when he was like 18 or whatever, but he was trying to go for the national team for Taekwondo. Dude, he has some reasonable skill, or had some anyways. Mm-hmm.
And 10 days away, talking about that, he's going to be debuting there at Phoenix during the desk. So John Anik replacement, I guess, for that event?
Maybe.
But for that specific event.
Is that the question? Like, is it?
I guess John Anik does both too. I was just John. Exactly. He does both. He's gonna do both. Eventually, he will be doing the play-by-play, but not at the 15th, January 15th. Okay. That's the event with BJ Penn.
Yeah. BJ Penn, motherfucker. BJ Penn.
Todd Duffy is gonna
return. Jackson's motherfucker at Jackson's.
Yeah, but still, it might be too late. We'll see though. It's a tough opponent. Yair Rodriguez could.
I know.
One punch KO him. Anyways, Todd Duffy's returning against Mark Goodbeer, or Godbeer, sorry, Godbeer,
at
UFC 209. I don't know if that has a main event, unless that's the Alistair Overeem event. With
Could be.
Hunt. Oh, yeah. Hey, look at that. It is that event, but there is no main event yet.
Yeah.
So that's not the main event. Weird.
Yeah. I'm not sure if it... Yeah, it might end up being.
It's possible.
But for pay-per-view, I don't know if they might not make that a pay-per-view if that's the main event.
Yes, I guess. But I would pay for that. That's a pretty all right fight.
Oh, it's just going to be number four for
Hunt. Oh, here's the thing. There's no title.
Yeah.
So everybody's like, we can't have a title. We got to have a title. No,
I don't give a shit about that. It's just like Overeem got knocked up. Fuck out in his last fight, and Hunt kind of got screwed over by fighting somebody who was juiced to the fucking gills.
Well, so he did it three times in a row. Imagine if this fight, for whatever reason.
Well, that's what I mean. If Omarine tests positive.
That's four. Okay. Oh, my God. So this was later in the news. I guess I can just bring this up right now. So he agreed to that fight, right, Hunt, this week? Mm-hmm. He actually agreed to that fight last week, but he said he wanted some provisions to protect him against him failing a USADA
test.
Yeah. And he said he had to agree to it without all those provisions to feed my family, which, hey, it's probably true because UFC fighters don't make that much money, so. And Mark Hunt, the way Mark Hunt came in the UFC,
like if you win,
yeah,
you can make some pretty good money, dude. If you don't win, you're fucked.
Well, dude, if you look at how Mark Hunt came in the UFC, Dana White didn't even really like him. He just thought that he was a fat piece of shit at first, not to be mean or anything, but that's pretty much what his opinion was. He came over from Pride. He wasn't even much a box. He was a kickboxer when he came over, really.
Well, he still is a kickboxer.
Well, yes, for sure. But he did compete in some MMA before that, too. So, it's not like he was an amateur or anything like that. He came He was always deadly, and he proved that ever since he was in the UFC. But he had to prove it.
Yes.
He had little cans to fight at the beginning. It was nothing for him. Compared to what he fought in fucking Japan. And those guys were on roids.
Yeah.
He might have been on roids too.
Maybe.
It's Japan. I'm not going to talk shit about that. Well, he could have done it. It wasn't illegal.
But the issue with Hunt is, if he cleaned up his diet and did things, he could be fighting at light heavy. And then if he fought at light heavy, that would be, he would be fucking.
Oh, no, but he's the KFC king.
Like, I don't give a shit about that crap. Like, I don't, like, the whole thing with Cormier and all that. Like, he did it. So
yeah,
why
but
the fuck?
Cormier is not big country or anything like that. Come on. That's not the same comparison. He's the KFC king.
Well, I'm sure there would have been some crispy chicken in Cormier's past.
Oh, possibly, but maybe he chilled out on it. Maybe he eats healthier crispy chicken now.
It's not deep fried.
Yeah, he oven cooks that
three
stuff
times.
Now.
Yeah.
I don't know what to tell you.
I just don't like that they...
I mean, he's in Australia, man. He probably gains all that weight back on the flight.
He's on, I don't know. New Zealand. Well, he might be
New Zealand. Sure, wherever he is. He's probably
I don't know where he fights out of, actually. I know he's from New Zealand. I don't know where he fights out of.
I think he's still out there because he wants to be around his family, right? So I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, but that he could have moved to Australia.
Oh, I think he's in Australia. I think this is family. Living in Sydney. There you go.
Okay.
Lineker suffered a broken jaw at UFC 207 in the first round.
Wow.
Yeah, he looks pretty tough that whole time because he didn't really look like he had a broken jaw.
No.
So there you go. I like those guys where you can't really tell. There's sometimes where the guys go like, "Oh, my hand's broken," and it turns out it's not actually broken. It just really hurts. And I get it, but it's just weird. Like, just don't say anything. You realize that the opposite corner could be listening to their iPhone right now, right? And be going like, I heard that corner say that his hand's broken. Just fuck him up. It's on the internet. It's right there. You get Fight Pass, you get your phone. Just fucking put some headphones in during the breaks. And then they're, hey, I heard him say his hand's broken. There we go. Done deal. It's weird. I don't get why they do that. So Ferguson Nurmagomedov, the saga continued this week, and Nurmagomedov offered to pay Ferguson an extra $200,000 to fight.
Mm-hmm. And Ferguson said, "Fuck no, I'm scared of you, bitch."
I didn't necessarily heard it. I didn't hear it that way. The reason I didn't hear it that way is because, like, dude, they're in the same business. They're doing the same job. Like, why would your opponent be fucking paying you? Like, no, you thank you, but no. That's what I would say. I get it.
Well, it's because Ferguson wanted more money after. Yeah. Like, he signed a new contract about 8 months ago or 10 months ago or something like that from Dana White. What's Dana White said? So his contract's quite new. And if he wins the next fight, then he has reason to ask for more money because he would be the interim champion. But he hasn't won that fight yet. So I don't really know what the fuck. Like, he was calling him out, and then for like some really stupidly close fight, and then blanking on the name. So the Eagle said, no, I'll fight you like the month after that or something like that. And then Ferguson said, nope, nope, nope.
The thing about this is, I don't know. Like,
yeah,
And it was just, the thing about short notice fights too, is I feel like they should probably get compensated a little bit more if they're going to take a fucking short notice fight.
Well, what's the thing of a short notice fight, well, though? Like, you talking about like what Ferguson Diaz did with...
Wasn't Ferguson scheduled against somebody? No, am I?
No, no, okay, he fought RDA a couple of months ago. So the thing is, he has more rest time than the Eagle, so I don't, like, I get, like, it was I think it was the end of February was the original thing, and Nurmagomedov's dad said, no, you need more time to rest.
Mm-hmm.
And then they said, okay, let's do it for March. And then Ferguson's like, nope, March. Nope, I'm not doing that one.
You know, the fight. Then he starts asking one.
For more money to fight in March. And then he comes out and says, okay, I'll give you $200,000.
And then 2 weeks from now, he tests positive. Who knows?
Yeah, I don't know.
There's so many legit reasons why Ferguson could have said no, but at the same time, like, come on.
Yeah, but guy. He didn't give a reason in any of anything of
he
anywhere.
Doesn't need to, though. He doesn't really need to. I'm just playing the devil's advocate here. I'm not a huge Ferguson guy. I'm not like I love Ferguson, I'm going to defend him here, but, you know, you know.
But the thing is, like, in this situation of that, he called out, he called him out, mm-hmm. and then they say no to that fight, and then there's another fight a month later, and then he says, no, I want more money. That sounds a little weird to me.
Yeah. Oh, no, for sure.
So it's just in that situation, yeah, you do somewhat need to explain yourself to the public, because especially when this was all on Twitter, and so everyone can see it, and it starts going to news outlets and or what the hell ever.
Unless you're Ronda Rousey, then you don't need to explain anything.
Well, the look.
Unless you want to make babies, and that's
why I don't. I'm blaming Edmund on 95% of that. But
hey. What the babies? No.
The whole
losing stuff.
32,
yes.
Or 42-second fight.
Well, both of them. Yeah. Yeah. Sure. Let's blame him for everything.
Because, like, I don't head movement, people. Like, it's called like moving. It's not. You don't. Well, it's not even. Fist. You move it to the side or back.
Well, like, we can talk about that in the second.
She was moving her face into the punches. It looked horrible.
We'll talk about that during the results because, yeah, there's stuff to be said about that. But, hey, I'll skip this one real quick just to touch on Brian Caraway is injured for the UFC Fight Night 103 card against Jimmy Rivera. And that's the 15th card with, what's his
face? So what, Tate broke his penis?
So here's the thing. It says undisclosed injury. So
yeah, that's what I mean.
But the thing about that is I feel like everybody should fucking have undisclosed injuries. Like, it should always be undisclosed. Like, I fucked up my knee. Why should it be anybody's business that I fucked up my knee? Just let me recover and then I'll come back.
Unless there's a surgery involved, and then that would likely come into play, but
yeah, but you don't really need to say that I'm gone off to surgery for my knee. You could just say, "Hey, I need surgery for this injury."
Well, the UFC's paying for the surgery.
Yeah,
so
the UFC needs to know, and if they want to release that, then sure.
Yes, fair enough. Sure. But again, yeah, like who is he saying this to? And again, the UFC could know what the injury is.
Yeah.
But he's just not. They're not disclosing any information.
Yeah, because if you look at the NHL and stuff, that's usually what they say. Or
yeah.
I think they made a rule where they have to disclose where it's upper or lower body. Yeah, which is pretty stupid. But hey, whatever.
Could be your big toe, or it could be your fucking hamstring,
or your penis, like you said.
That is lower body.
Yeah. You could still play, though, with that. That's the thing. Like, yeah, my penis is gone, but let me play some goaltender here in the NHL. Why not? It's gone, but I just got to forget about it for this next 3 hours. Right,
if you've bent your penis, oh, God.
Trying to think if I've had, like, a penis injury. I don't think so. I've gotten hit there where it hurt, but nothing was wrong. I was fine. It just hurt.
I know. In around the third or fourth time in one night, the skin was.
That's. Don't do that. if you get to the point where it hurts, and why even keep going?
I didn't.
That's some next level stuff.
Yeah. It was like rubbing it on concrete.
Mm-hmm. That's some next level stuff there. All right. Chet Congo and Ollie Thompson are going to fight at Bellator 172. And I got added to the card. Featuring Fedor Emelianenko and Matt Mitrione. And then Adam Piccolotti versus Brent Primus is also added to that card. So two new fights, and they're on the main card. So they're going to be on Spike.
Fedor versus...
That's an all right fight, but I'm pretty sure Mitrione's going to kill him.
Oh, I'm pretty sure he will. It's just how far he's fallen. Like, Fedor was supposed to be like, well, God, and
Fedor hasn't even really been fighting constantly for like what the last 3 years.
Yes, and that is like he's been having like one fight a year for the past like four
years. Because and a lot of that has to do with the death of his dad, and he was pretty much retired for I want to say the last year or 2 years. He hasn't really been fighting.
That Maldonado fight was
because that Maldonado fight was the last fight. What was that? Was that early 2016? I guess.
I don't think it was. I think it was mid-ish.
Maybe. But yeah. Anyways, whatever. Bellator 171 is the card with Tito Ortiz. He's going to retire after that fight, no matter what, with Chael Sonnen. So even if he beat, imagine if he beats Chael Sonnen, and he leaves. That'd be pretty funny.
Yeah.
But yeah. And then the next card, fucking Fedor and Matt Mitrione. Yeah. Whatever, man. Fedor's.
It was June 17th.
Okay.
16. Mm-hmm. So, like, pretty much smack dab in the middle of the year.
I have no problem with Bellator. And their cards have been less circusy as they've been in the past. Like, the first Ken Shamrock fight, was it against Royce Gracie or was it against. It was against Royce Gracie, wasn't it?
Was it Hoyce or was it the other Gracie?
That was Hoyce.
It was Hoyce?
Oh, definitely. Hoyce is the only one that would accept the fight.
But Hoyce is so much smaller than Shamrock.
You don't remember? He kicked him in the nuts and then the ref didn't see him and then he KO'd him. You don't remember that?
No. I didn't watch.
It was at the very beginning of last year. Oh, my God.
Will start watching Bellator a lot more because of they're actually starting to get some pretty good fighters because of people are getting pissed off at the UFC.
Yeah.
So
here's the thing. Next year, we need to do a thing where we actually, at the end of the MMA Awards right now, we will get some other categories prepared for next year. Because Ken Shamrock could have won something this year. Like a dubious.
Worst nut shot.
Yeah, worst nut shot of the year. Because the ref didn't even see it. And then he was complaining about it, and then he got KO'd. And it was like, oh, all right, fine. Why not? It was a shitty fight, though. But hey. And then who else did Ken Shamrock fight this year? It was some other dude. Was it? Oh, he's dead now.
Kimbo?
Kimbo, yeah. Yeah, he fought Kimbo this year before Dada 3000. That was a bad fight. All right. So Angela Lee is going to defend the one atom weight title in March against Jenny Huang. So there you go. I'm assuming Jenny is Chinese based on her name, but I could be wrong. Well, she's Taiwanese. She's Taiwan.
Thai? Okay.
Yeah.
Just give me a sec.
Sure, go for it. But yeah, so... Angela Lee, she's Canadian born, went to Hawaii for a while.
Hawaii, yeah.
And now she's in 1FC, which is, well, I guess they're just called 1 now. They took away the FC.
Mm.
And they're an Asian base. I think they're based out of Singapore. But whatever, man, it's Asia. They go everywhere. everywhere. I don't think they've been to Japan yet, but they're pretty much centralized in Asia. Japan's out, kind of out there. I think they've been in Korea, though. So, you know, they go everywhere where there's less demand for MMA, I guess. Because, you know, Japan, there's no problem with wrestling and MMA and all that goodness in Japan. I guess it's not called wrestling whatsoever in Japan. But whatever. Yeah. Whatever it's called. Whatever. Hybrid. Because there's a bunch of hybrids right now in Japan. Where it's like, hey, it's like kind of like wrestling, but it's MMA too. All right. Did you watch Looking for a Fight Season 2?
I did.
Yeah. What'd you think?
Dean Thompson's a hell of a lot better than Nick the Tooth.
Yeah. I thought that last season already. So.
Yeah, I know. Because, yeah, now it actually seems like they make sense together. Like, Sarah and Dean are actually, like, friends. So they were in the house together. They compete together. They're heads of two separate gyms and whatever. So they're still obviously...
They don't have a problem saying that they're masturbating in front of each other. You know? All that goodness. You know?
But, yeah. Well, it's just, like, Nick was just weird. And I don't entirely get the whole thing.
Me neither. But, like, he was an interesting personality, and if he could have been all right with them, then yeah, sure. Like,
it just makes so much more sense. Like, Dean just decided he doesn't want to fight anymore. He still loves fighting. Yes. So he's like, he goes to Alliance, and he's one of the head guys at Alliance. Like, dude, like, Alliance, and then Sarah Luongo, like, those are like top gyms in the U.S. Like, they're probably two of the top five gyms in the U.S. Like, there'd be Alliance, and then ATT, Black Zillions, and then Jackson's.
Not only that, but look, Dean is up for anything. He'll say yes to anything that's going on.
Not even the hot dogs.
If there's a little arm bar or, you know, a little tap out action going on, Dean's not going to be crying about it the next day.
You know? Well, the thing is, he's a legit black belt, so he's not.
No, but even, you know, I'm sure that sometimes when they're bored,
they're going to get in a
tussle. And the tussle might end with a winner, quote unquote winner.
Rolling, yeah, fair enough. But
I know, but let's just say that if they're playfully rolling around somewhere and somebody just comes out on top, it's not going to end up in fucking drama with those two guys. No. You know, they've already settled their fucking drama.
I think Dean would admit that Sarah is a better jiu-jitsu guy than he is, but then stand up, I would think Dean would have it, but. Dean's also a hell of a lot more limber because Sarah's packed on some weight. Holy crap.
Yeah. And Sarah didn't even eat the hot dogs.
Yeah. No, he wouldn't. He refused to eat the hot dogs.
Honestly, I don't know about red dye hot dogs.
Those did not look. Oh, God.
I'm sure they still taste exactly the same, but that red dye just fucks with me.
No, I don't know. I'm good.
Hey, I like a good old hot dog. I'm all about like them hot dogs.
Two or three times a year, maybe.
Times a year? Like once a month. Once a month, man. It's pretty cheap. Yeah. Just throw that in some water and you boil it. There you go, man. You got some hot dogs.
Gotta barbecue that, too. But sure.
Yeah, but I mean, it's winter right now. I can't do that shit. Not here, anyways.
That's your problem, not mine.
Not here. I could throw it like in a toaster oven or something. It'd make it taste better, I suppose.
Fire makes it good.
Yeah, but I mean, when you have the next best thing, which is not being soaked in boily water. Depends what kind of wieners you get, I guess, too.
Yeah.
Some are better than others, that's for sure.
So, next topic.
Yeah, Bellator's Michael Venom Page. He posted a video dancing to Ronda Rousey's loss. And he was saying, like, do the Ronda Rousey. It was pretty lame. That's why I didn't get the video.
I don't, it was whatever. I don't know why the fuck a fighter would do that to another fighter.
And his last fight was shit.
Yeah. No, and top it, like, unless you have some serious beef with that fighter, like personal beef or something, like, which, again, most people
I hate Ronda Rousey. Look, I could take these scissors right now and cut her up. That's how much I hate her. I'm not gonna post a video of her loss. Whatever, dude. Yeah. She showed up. She sucked. I laughed, and that was it. I didn't. I'm not going to mock.
I wanted
her.
A better fight than that. Was the
oh, for problem, sure.
But yeah,
for sure. But you know, what can you do?
This, yeah, we'll talk about that in a bit.
Okay. Well, there you go. We're straight into UFC 207. Yeah. Did you watch any of the prelims or anything like that?
Well, there's only the one prelim, was there not?
No, well, the one that was on Fight Pass, and then there's the ones that were on TV.
Oh, okay, yeah, sorry. I watched the ones on TV, yeah.
Okay, well, the one that was on Fight Pass did not last very long. 3 minutes and 33 seconds. Yeah. It was Alex Oliveira versus Tim Means. Okay, so this was a big shit show fuck fest. I don't know what the hell they were doing during this or what they were thinking. Okay. So Alex Oliveira is on the ground. I clicked on the wrong thing. Okay, so he's on the ground.
Well, he had two knees on the ground.
No, one knee.
No. Well, he was starting to get up, so yeah, then he had one knee.
Yes.
Tim Means threw the knee.
Yes.
Put him back down to two knees. Hit him again. When he had two knees on the ground.
No, and he had Oliveira one knee the whole time. He had one knee the whole time.
No, he dropped back down and then he came up.
No. It was one knee the whole time. I'm telling you, it was one knee the whole time. It doesn't even matter if it was one or two. Because
down to fucking opponent.
It was one knee the whole time. Like another knee might have dropped before, but when the knees landed, the pertinent knees, there was only one knee on the ground. Now, here's the thing. A lot of them were saying like a 3 point of contact. Okay, let's say it is 3 points of contact. It was fucking 2 feet and one knee. His foot was still on the fucking ground. Yes. So, like,
yeah,
I was listening to it. Okay, so they have Mark Ratner off to the side, right? He's like the UFC rules and regulations guy. I don't know what his exact title is. It's something like that. But
I would think the main reason for that rule is so you cannot do exactly what Tim Means did.
Yes.
Or head stomp when the guy's on the ground.
Well, so they were talking about how the rule is going to change in 2017, right? And it is going to change, but what exactly happened is still illegal in 2017. Yes. The only difference is the hand touching. That's the only difference in 2017.
And that whole hand touching, that should not be a downed opponent by my definition. No, it should be if you're on your ass or on your knees, you're a downed opponent.
And
or
those,
on your back.
Those were totally illegal knees. And then, so it was, well, what's his name?
To the point
what's
that
the ref's name that was refereeing this one?
Big guy with a beard.
Yeah. Yeah.
Shit.
For some reason, I have Mike, but it's not Mike. It's freaking.
Fuck.
Mike is a smaller guy.
Fuck. I should know this. It like his face is in my brain, but I can't think of his
name.
He's
bald. I know exactly who it is, but I don't remember his name. Yeah, I don't know. Wikipedia doesn't tell me which one. Anyways, whatever the hell his name is, he called it a no contest.
Yeah, which is bullshit.
Which is totally bullshit. This was a DQ. Wait,
I don't understand why they would call it a no. Like, that just does not make any sense.
It doesn't make any sense at all. Like, even if it was accidental, it's still fucking against the rules. Unless it's an eye poke. Like, an eye poke is accidental, then you end it. If a grind shot ends it before the second round, then yeah, that's accidental. It's no contest. But even a grind shot after the third round begins, they're going to judge it based on what was available to judge. This was DQ. It's just like John Jones' 12-6 elbow on Matt Hamill.
Yeah.
He didn't know that rule existed, but
that was also John McCarthy, so that's slightly different.
Well, but John McCarthy, I guess, knows the rules.
Yeah, well, I think that's really what it comes down to.
Yeah, no, this should get overturned because even Tim Means said, "I didn't know the rules. I did it. It should be a DQ. He even said it. I watched
after the fact.
Yeah. After the fight.
It wasn't during the interview.
No. Not right after the interview. It was
not with
Rogan. It was in the back.
Yeah.
Ariel Helwani was there with a bunch of other press.
Okay.
Yeah. No, he said that he didn't know that was the rule. He thought that the hand needed to be down. I was just like, man, what the hell?
No.
What the fuck? You're an idiot. But no, everybody was an idiot. I was watching this telecast. Joe Rogan didn't know. Mike Rogan didn't know. And Mark Ratner, the dude that should fucking know because he worked for the commission. Now he works for the USC in charge of fucking knowing the rules. Didn't know. He didn't know.
I I don't get that. Like, yeah, if your knee's down, you are, it, yeah, anything but the soles of your feet,
dude,
you're down.
Oh, dude, I was screaming at my TV. I was just, dude, this, it's a no DQ. This is over right now. What the fuck are you doing? Why is Mark Ratner saying that was a legal shot? What the fuck is going on? And then Joe Rogan was just like, oh, well, Mark Ratner said that was illegal. That was illegal, so that was cool. That should not be stopped. And it's just like, what the fuck? The knee was down the whole time.
Yeah.
Anyways, there you go. That's how the event started. That,
well, yeah.
With bullshit.
That angle of somebody being on their knees and somebody standing up in front of them and being able to hit their head, like how much more of an impact you'd have because,
well, so
your
the
knee
first knee
is so much closer to the guy's head.
The first knee was like, oh, okay. Like, okay, cool. Maybe. Eh. And then he threw like two other ones. And it was just like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
It's fucking done now. Anyways.
No, that was completely, because they did re-show it or whatever. I saw it. I did. Maybe it was a YouTube or whatever.
I think they might have shown it on sometime, because they did run low on, like, the two first fights on the TV ran fast, so they might have filled in the time with this quickie here of a replay.
So, but yeah, it was a horribly, like, horrible illegal knee, from what I'm concerned, like, as far as I'm concerned.
Let's talk about the TV prelims here. The first one of the night was Nico Price defeated Brendan Thatch with a submission arm triangle choke in the first round.
Yeah.
Right near the end.
That seemed, once it got to the ground, that seemed horribly one-sided.
Yes, it was.
Yeah, that's all I remember thinking about that fight is that, okay, this doesn't look too bad. And then it got to the ground, and then he just, holy shit. Just absolute, like he had him in body triangles and all, like he just was riding his back. He was doing, like, he did whatever the fuck he wanted to once they were on the ground.
And Thatch is the veteran too. You're like, whoa, okay.
Yeah.
This Nico Price guy.
Yeah. Price was, yeah, that was his first UFC event.
So it'll be interesting to see where he goes from here, but hey, good start. Yeah. And he was calling out for the 50K. Two guys in a row did that. Just stop doing that. Stop doing that.
He did not get it.
Stop that. Stop that, guys. We don't need that. But hey, Alex Garcia KO punched Mike Pyle to hell.
That
so
was,
the punch hurt, but then he was so knocked out that his head whipped back. On the
It was the angle of the shot and everything like that. So yeah, his head hit the mat very hard. And he bounced back up and then hit again.
Yes.
Like it, yeah.
Brutal KO.
Pyle's 42 or something like that. I think it might be about time he.
It might be. Pyle's always entertaining is the thing. Like, he could come back from this fight and then KO somebody himself. And
true.
You know, but he should probably stop.
He's 41. Like, I don't. Like, you're getting to the age that shit like that will fuck you up a lot more. It takes a lot longer. Like, he should not fight for a year after that type of knockout.
Mm-hmm. Being knocked out like that. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So, like, I think that should be about it for Pyle, personally speaking.
It depends how much he makes and,
how
many
also
fights he has left. Like, let's say he has like one fight left on his contract and maybe he wants his last fight to be better than this fucking KO.
True. But again, like, he really should take 10 to 12 months off after something. Like, he got, like, I'm sure he has a horrible concussion.
Oh, hey,
like,
here you go.
Was
reported payouts. Fuck. So I'm going to look at Mike Pyle. $55,000 for getting knocked the fuck out. So, I mean. Yeah.
So if he wins, he gets paid fairly well.
Yeah. So and then that's not including anything except for his actual payout. So his Reebok must be a little bit better than everybody else's too, because he's been fighting for a while, so.
Well, he also actually had. There is a Pyle set that you can buy as well, I believe.
Mm-hmm. So he might want to fight another one.
Maybe.
I wouldn't. It totally depends on his contract. Like, if he has like one fight left, then maybe call it quits. If he has three fights left, maybe he wants to fight a couple more.
I don't know. Like, I don't think he should be fighting for a while.
Take a year off. Don't even fucking train. Like,
yeah, but again,
like,
you're saying take a year off or whatever. Like, he's 41, so he'll be 43 by the time he fights again.
Again, it depends what he does. I have no idea what he does for a living. I have no idea of his personal
situation. He's a coach at Matt Hughes.
Yeah, and if you're around it all the time, then, man, it's hard to get away from it. I understand, like, being a coach is one thing. Oh, no, he could. He could, but, like, if he feels like he's still able to do it.
Yes,
like, man,
fair enough, but it's hard. He's getting up there.
It's just like anything, man. Like, let's say he had another career that was not MMA involved at all, then yeah, sure, fucking go do it, and then he would probably forget about it entirely and never want to do it again. But he's fucking around it all day.
Yeah.
All day, so eventually he's probably going to feel like, hey, maybe I can still do this. Anyways, yeah, the next two fights, I ended in decision, but I still feel like they were very good fights. Maybe not the main event, but Antonio Carlos Jr. defeated Marvin Vettori. I thought that this was a pretty competitive fight. I liked the fight. I don't know about you.
I wasn't overly impressed by either of them, but wasn't.
I'm not going to say that I was
horribly boring. Like,
yeah,
I wasn't.
It wasn't boring, but I, you know, that's the best you can say about this fight, really.
Yeah.
It wasn't boring.
Yeah.
And the right guy won, I suppose. So there you go. Antonio Carlos Jr. can keep marching forward. And then Johnny Hendricks missed weight by 2.5 pounds. So this was a catchweight 173.5 pounds. Neil Magny defeated Johnny Hendricks via controversial decision, I suppose, because the crowd was booing like madness. Yeah.
I agreed exactly with what the judges
did. Me too.
Did.
Yeah, me too. Like, that's exactly.
It was two to one. Yeah.
The last round could have went either way, and then Neil Magny dominated the last round, and you were like, oh, all right, I guess I'm going to give this round to Neil, and Neil wins.
Yeah.
Oh, and it wasn't even just the last minute of that last round, too. He was on the bottom of that last round, but he was also landing the most damage.
He was doing submissions. He was hitting from the bottom. Yep. The judges actually did something right.
Yeah, for sure. Like, Johnny Hendricks was the second round he won, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. The second round, well, he actually did
something. It would have to have been.
Yeah, he definitely did more shit in that second round with the top position he had.
Again, though, in the first round, Hendricks was on top. But again, Magny was doing submissions, striking from the bottom, doing really nice little elbows.
He was on top, but before he ended up on top, Neil Magny did some pretty okay stuff on the feet in the first round.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was a good fight.
Yeah.
But I was heading into this fight expecting the worst already. So, hey.
Mm. It's just like Hendricks just sat on. When he was on top, he literally just sat on top of him. Mm-hmm. Did absolutely nothing.
Yes. Yes. Especially in the third round.
Yeah.
It was brutal to watch in the third. Just like, man, well, it sucks that Neil is stuck there, but he's doing stuff.
Mm.
And that's how Fox Sports 1 ended. Yeah, good stuff. that sold a lot of pay-per-views there. They were like, oh my God, that Neil Magny fight was so awesome. Let's buy this pay-per-view. But no, that's not.
Yeah.
So, talk about pay-per-view buys.
Did they release any of the numbers for the buys?
I don't think so, but the early numbers from Dave Meltzer himself, the man, 1.1 million are the early numbers right now for that thing. That's a lot, Steiner. That's a lot more than a million.
Yeah. Well, I just was it though? What was it really? 1.1?
Like, well, it's going to be at least 1 million, dude. It's going to be at least one.
You're also really only selling pay per views in North America.
Well, yeah.
Well, the thing, there'd be a lot of people watching in Europe, but it's all just television deals there because it's at like 4 o'clock in the morning. So it's just the way they. I guess they would still be. The UFC would still have to be getting.
So it did. It did 1.1 on a fucking Friday.
Yeah,
is a thing. Imagine if Ronda Rousey actually talked a bunch of shit for this fight, and it was on a Saturday. Jesus.
But the thing is,
Christ.
It still sold 1.1.
Yes, which is more than fucking anything else, almost.
Outside of 106.
Well, anything Conor McGregor is on.
What did? Both of those. I know the second one outsold the first one.
Yeah, no, Conor McGregor. Anything with Conor McGregor on a pay-per-view has done more than 1.1.
Okay.
Yeah.
But again, that happened without her doing any press.
But imagine if she did. Oh my God.
Would it have changed anything?
I think it would have. Like, I think it would have.
I don't think it, like, that's a pretty big number.
It's big, but it's not that big. It's about the same number as her last fight with Holm.
Right. So exactly.
Yeah. So I think it could have sold a little bit more. I think it could have sold a little bit more. And imagine if this was a rematch with Holm. Could have been maybe a little bit more.
That would have sold more.
I still think Ronda Rousey, maybe even just at the weigh-in. At the weigh-in, be like, hey, Joe, I don't really want to talk, but hey, thanks, fans. I'm going to fight for you guys tomorrow. I'm going to kick some fucking ass. Like that. Even her just saying that alone might have sold like a little bit
more. I honestly don't think it would have sold anymore. Mm. Like, I'm actually quite surprised it sold as many as it did.
I am not, man. When you said that half a million last Friday? Week, I was like, that's fucking crazy.
Friday? Why the fuck is it on a Friday?
Because the Ronda Rousey's fans are not us. We are not them. We're not the people that will go out and buy a Ronda Rousey pay-per-view. We're not the demographic. We're not 13-year-old girls that love fighting, okay? That's just not what it is. We don't watch Ellen. I watch Ellen when Ronda Rousey's on it and maybe some other times, but that's not the point. That's not the point. Now, my parents really like watching that shit, so I'm kind of, whenever I'm over there, it's always like, fucking, let's watch Ellen because it's on TV. No! No! Let's play something else.
Okay. Yeah.
But, yeah. I am not surprised at all because Conor McGregor sells more Friday. Than her all the time. Like, that's the thing that people forget to fucking look at all the time. Conor McGregor sells way more than fucking Ronda. Way more all the time. But yeah, the thing about Ronda is she sells to a crowd that is totally not that same crowd. It's totally a different crowd. It's not the same people that buy those pay-per-views.
What was the pay-per-view buy for the Holm Ronda fight?
You tell me,
like,
man.
Like 1-1, 1-2?
When I heard similar, I'm assuming it was around 1.1.
Yeah, so she sold the exact same without doing any media. So if she did all that media, she would have gotten 100,000 more buys?
I'm looking at this here. It says Rousey versus Holm looks to have topped 1 million. What is that? I don't know.
Yeah. So it looks like she sold the exact same without having to do any media. So the name alone sold the ticket or sold the buys. It
did, but imagine if she did more shit.
I don't think it would have done anything.
I think it would have. It would totally have.
If she did the same, like, you'd have to look at her last fight.
Even for Rousey's fans, even for her fans, that there were so many people that did not even know she was fighting on Friday that either love her or love the UFC. And, like, it's just so weird. It's just so weird.
Well, if they loved the UFC, they would have known that event was on.
Yes and no.
Then they obviously are not hardcore fight fans.
Like, they might have watched just that fucking thing on, I don't know, man, on Fox, and they were like, sweet. It was fun. Had a good time, like, there.
Like, if the same number of pay-per-views sold, then I don't see her doing anything. If she did all that shit before and sold that much, and she didn't do anything and sold the same amount, that's just how many people watch her pay-per-views.
Yeah, I still think it could have been more. That's just what I think, though. I'm not going to defend it more than that.
Anyway, so Kim and Schofield, or I said that horribly wrong.
Sure. Ray Borg and Luis Smolka. We didn't talk about that.
We didn't talk. Okay.
That fight was okay. It went to decision. Ray Borg missed the weight, and he pretty much killed Luis Smolka. Yep. Yeah. So that kind of sucked for Smolka. Some rounds were even given 10 to 8.
Yeah.
So it was a pretty bad showing, I got to say. But Ray Borg looked bigger too, and he kind of grinded it out. So there's not much to say about that fight, to be honest.
Nope.
Stun Gun Kim, Stun Gun versus Tarek Seffedine. Again, this was another fight. Not much to say about it, except for the judging. Fucking a judge gave a 3-27 to Tarek Seffedine. What? What fucking fight was he watching? He gave that fucking all to Tarek Seffedine. Because Dun Young Kim definitely had him in spots. I would say the first and second. The thing about this fight was so close. All the rounds were so close. But still, I think
Stun Gun won. I could maybe see a split, but I don't see. I could have either been a 29-28 flip. I can maybe somewhat understand, but.
Yeah, me too.
I don't know.
I think I gave the first two to Dun Young. The thing about this weekend is I did not take any notes. There's so much stuff going on this weekend that I was just like, I'm just going to watch it and not take any notes. And the stuff that was amazing, I'll remember it. TJ Dillashaw and John Lineker. This fight wasn't bad. It's just here. I remember the fight that was supposed to be on this card that we missed last week. What's this? The heavyweight fight was supposed to take place.
Kane and... Yeah. Verdum? Was it Verdum?
Yeah,
or?
Kane and Verdum. Yeah, it was Kane and Verdum. So that was supposed to be the third to last fight. And no, that did not happen. So yeah, this fight was really good, but TJ Dillashaw just pretty much tore him apart.
Yeah. Yeah, just speed difference.
It was 30 to 26. So there was a round there that was 10 to 8. I think that was the second round. Yeah, it wasn't even close. Not even close.
177 to 51 were the strikes.
Mm-hmm. I think after the first round, the strikes were like 30 to fucking 5 or something like that. It was ridiculous. Yeah,
that was pretty one-sided fight.
Yeah. Cody Garbrandt, Jesus Christ, in the bantamweight championship fight. He tore apart Dominic Cruz, except for maybe the last part of the fight there. He took it easy, and it could have backfired on him.
Yeah.
But he won. Pretty decisively, I gotta say, like the run, was it the fourth or the third round? It was 10-8 for Cody Garbrandt.
Yeah, no, the fourth round was definitely a 10-8 for Garbrandt. I actually had it scored 47-47. Mm-hmm. I gave the first two rounds to Cruz and then 3 and 4 to Garbrandt, 4 being a 10-8, and then gave 5 to Cruz. That's the way I scored it. Now,
I think the way it went for me was the three middle rounds I might have given it to Cody.
So you gave 2 to round 2 to Cody. Now the thing is, like, in the first, it wasn't in, like, did he knock him down? I think it was, he did the knockdowns
in second.
Round 3.
I think it was in the second.
3 and 4. Like, 4, he knocked him down like 5 times.
I think the one knockdown where he kind of like laid down.
I think that was even though they're only counting that there was 2 knockdowns, which I don't like, he knocked him down.
Oh, no, the fourth round had like fucking like 4.
Yeah.
4 or 5. It might have been the 4. It might have been the 3rd. I might be misremembering that. But yeah, the first Cody Garbrandt one was shocking because he went down really hard, but then as soon as he hit the ground, Cruz was just back up.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
That may have been the second round, but the thing is, because he got straight back up, and then Garbrandt, even though he was doing like saying like it's over or whatever, and then it's just done. No, he got right back up and but it's just the strikes. If you go strikes by strikes of just each round,
like, Garbrandt pretty much won the striking competition, didn't he?
In numbers? No. He lost every round.
Oh, every round? Crazy.
Three and four were very close.
Yeah.
Exactly. It was this damage done on each strike, which is the big thing.
And it's still controversy on whether or not that cut was a punch or a head-to-head contact on that one, headbutt. It's still, if you look at the footage,
I think that's what happened in the second round, was it not?
That was in the second. That was at the very beginning of the second round. They collided heads, and Dominic Cruz, that cut between rounds when they showed it looked goddamn insane.
Yes, like half his eyebrow was missing.
Oh, it was gross. Yeah. And hey, if it was a punch and fine, great. That was all awesome. But man, if it was a headbutt and they ended that fight because of that cut, ugh, yeah. I would have been so devastated. I'd have been like, no. No, but it was a really entertaining fight. And then it was cool to see Cruz in the post-fight conference.
Mm.
He was Cruz. That's the thing I love about Cruz is that he's always Cruz. It doesn't matter if he's fighting before a fight. Like, even when he talks shit, he sounds so respectable. You're never like, oh man, listen to this trash talker, man. He talks so much bullshit that it doesn't even make sense. No, it always makes sense.
Yeah.
He's always articulate about it. Like, yep. Even through this loss, Dominic Cruz still looks amazing. So the thing about Cruz, though, is that where does he go from here?
I have a feeling that he underestimated Garbrandt's.
Yes.
Or how much he got into Garbrandt's head, I guess, would be the best way of saying it.
I guess so.
Because, he thought he had him, mind fucked. And
I think you're right. But at the same time, I think that Garbrandt always had the chance. And Cruz, I don't know. Cruz might just be getting to that age where he's slowing down a little bit.
I don't know, but if you look at the actual numbers, it was that he, as Cruz said in the post fight, is that he was moving to Garbrandt opposed to Garbrandt moving to him. And mm-hmm, most of mm-hmm. Cruz's fights is he's the one who's the matador or whatever.
Oh, yeah. Oh, especially near the end of the fight, it got even more apparent. Just like, whoa, look at this guy. He's chasing him crazy now.
Yeah. And I just don't think Cruz trains enough in that fashion to have had that work for him. He's typically not the aggressor in a lot of his fights. Yes, he's his footwork and lets him pick everyone apart and do whatever, but in direct, and Garbrandt did a pretty good job counterpunching and stuff like that too. So it's,
you know, Garbrandt was light on his feet the whole goddamn fight, which was the thing that surprised me. Right off the bat, it was just like, whoa, okay, this guy might be on the same level. And then it was like, whoa, all right, I guess this fight's over.
Mm.
That was my reaction the whole five rounds. It was just like, damn it. Wanted Cruz to win, but guess he's not going to win. And I'm not opposed to Cody Garbrandt. Even Cody Garbrandt, after the fight, he seemed less like a Neanderthal and more of a dude. Just a dude. You know, he might not be the most intelligent dude, but he's there. And he just wants to fight. And I'm all right with that. But keep your girl abroad. Okay? Just shut down her Twitter right now. She doesn't need to be on Twitter. Mm. She's doing that kind of shit.
Yeah, that was weird.
And that's not, I'm not talking shit, Cody. Just your girlfriend does not need to be on Twitter talking to no fighters.
Yeah. Okay?
That's it. End of discussion. All right. And then the main event lasted 48 seconds. If you paid for the main event, congrats. $60. 48 seconds. How do you feel? No, actually, this might have been the fight that I had the third most reaction to of the whole year. I jumped out of my fucking seat. I was freaking out the whole 48 seconds. So it was all right.
Yeah, I don't...
If every punch Ronda, that landed, I was like, ah!
Yeah, it just, as I was saying before, her head movement seemed to be her face moving towards Nunes's fist.
Did I send you the audio of her corner?
Yes.
Oh, better than watching it with the original audio.
I've listened to a lot of people that actually know Ronda, are personally friends with her or personally trained with her or met her or whatever, Sonnen, Rogan, and all those, and whenever they see her train, she's hitting mitts. That's her stand up is hitting mitts,
mm-hmm.
not actually sparring and figuring out head movement, how to read a person to where they're coming in to actually dodge that. Or if she had no ability to dodge the punches whatsoever.
I heard that they said that she hasn't sparred since the Holly Holm fight, which is just crazy. How can you do that?
Well, even well, sparring, like, it's not even just sparring. Like, even if you're doing it just with me, like, you actually have to, like, you can't just do routinely, like, whatever. You actually have to have two people. Like, you don't have to go at 100%. You can go at 40% or whatever. Just don't have anything behind your punches. But you do have to figure out that head movement. Like, and that's one, like, her striking is rudimentary because she doesn't have the head. She has no counter striking ability whatsoever.
Well, that's pretty much why Nunez won, because she knew that heading in, and she knew that she was going to try to box with her.
She assumed that heading in. Now, the thing is, if she actually was at a real camp...
Well, yeah, no, that's, no. You say that she assumed it, but because she knows of her camp, and it's a little bit more of an educated guess than it is.
Fair enough. The thing is, like, if she was at Alliance or AKA or what, like, any real camp...
Yeah.
She would be a full fighter right now and not just be relying on her judo background.
Which she doesn't even do anymore.
Well, she hasn't been able to get a hold of the person. But, like, she's not... Like, judo has been pretty much proven to be the absolute worst base for MMA. Just because of the way you have to hook up to them and the way you throw them, you're coming off balance as somebody that actually knows Brazilian jiu-jitsu. Brazilian jiu-jitsu is pretty much made to counter a lot of that shit.
The main throw that they do in judo, you can easily flip that and reverse it.
Yeah. So, and yeah, it's
useful in judo because you just fucking slam them on their back and then you stay on top, and that's all you got to do. But when you're fighting MMA, like, what are you going to do? Slam them on their back and then that's it? You're like, cool.
Like, if she wants to continue fighting, which she obviously doesn't need to because she got paid $3 million for 42 seconds and she did no press or anything like that for any of that. Mm-hmm. So she literally got paid $3 million for 48 seconds.
To get knocked out on her feet.
Yep.
Yeah. I've heard people say that it ended early and, okay. So, no. Listen real quick. So, I kind of get where they're coming from, because let's say this was Mark Hunt, not white. He's not a white girl. Let's get that out of the way. Mark Hunt, not white and not a girl. He's neither of those two things, okay? Let's just say, okay? But if Mark Hunt was in this exact same situation where he was on his fucking feet getting lit the fuck up, there's no fucking ref that would have fucking stopped that. He would have been like, he's still on his feet. We're still good. Let's keep going, man. Mark Hunt. Fucking get killed. for just 1 second, just listen to that. I listened to somebody make that point the other day, and it's like, that's not entirely wrong. I don't disagree with that.
There's a lot of times I think fights should be stopped sooner than they are.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of fights.
And again, like, people take unnecessary damage. Like, again, what's the dumbass's name that used to be horrible at stopping fights? Short white guy.
Yeah, Italian dude.
Yamasaki? No.
No, that's the Asian. Mario is the Asian dude. Mazzagatti, something like that.
Yeah. Like, he was horrible at stopping fights at the right time. People took way too much damage. Like, and there's been a few other ones.
Sometimes he ended way too early too.
And again, like, Herb Dean has ended a couple of fights too early. The Barao versus California kid Cruz, or not Cruz? Sorry, Faber.
Yeah, Faber. Yeah.
It was just a really, he wasn't getting out of that position and he was taking damage. So he wasn't intelligently defending himself because he wasn't trying to improve his position. Was he taking any damage? Hell no. But, like, it's just a lot of weird shit.
There's a lot of semantics in the rules too. So you got,
And the thing is, in that situation, Herb Dean followed the rules. Mm-hmm. So he wasn't trying to improve his position. He was just turtled and that's over.
Like, that big country during his season of Tough, like, he said that, like, I'm just going to lay on top of dudes and lightly punch him in the face. And hey, they're not intelligently defending themselves.
Yeah. And yeah.
yeah. Like, I think refs are more educated now than they were back then. So that might not happen.
Can he? Well, the thing is, you're going to get a guy, like, especially in big countries, think he got people in crucifix positions that didn't know how to get out of it. You tell him to stand up?
Well, like,
he's a mounted fucking crucifix.
I'm sure there's some dudes that know how to get out of crucifixes, but then you get big country on you, and it's just like, well, fuck.
Even that, too. Yeah, and that's what Rampage was saying of, like, how the fuck you deal with all that blubber in your face. but even, like, just you're in mount, you can't tell that fighter to stand up or to have them break and have them stand up. He's in a mounted crucifix.
You just say the one thing you could say is say, hey, intelligently defend yourself, and then they just keep doing the same thing, exactly, and then you're like, well, shit, I have to end this right now because it's just the same.
Like, the thing is, big country's a nice guy. He didn't really want to hurt anyone, so that's what he did. He's not, like, an angel of any sorts, but the thing is, he doesn't, like, why do any unnecessary damage? Like, just, that's going to take a chance away, especially in Kimbo's position in that first fight of, like, that's definitely going to, if I really cut the shit out of him, he's not going to be able to train for the next 2 to 3 weeks, and that's really going to hurt his career in this sport.
So, do we have any other Ronda Rousey opinions before we move on?
She needs to change camps if she ever wants to fight again.
That's the obvious thing.
I'm just making that same point over and over and over and over again.
And it's nothing against Edmund personally. You suck, Edmund, but I don't know you personally, but you suck, and she should leave.
As an MMA coach, he is horrible.
Oh, what's his name? Travis Brown. Travis Brown has been nothing but shit.
Yep.
Since then.
Yep.
So.
And they have 3 or 4 UFC fighters, and they've all, like, Rousey's the only one that's really been able to win. But again, she was at a point in time where people didn't know how to beat her.
Once defend the judo.
Then
the armbar. They didn't know how to do that.
She was also fighting wrestlers for the lot. Like, Tate was a wrestler. Kat was a wrestler.
Yeah. Tate was the only one that knew how to defend any of that at the end.
Yeah.
And Kat just got overzealous with her shit, and she got caught with a punch. Anybody can do that. Like, the thing about Ronda Rousey is she can still fucking hit somebody. And
Look, she hits mitts really well, and she has great hand speed, and she hits really hard. But it's more than just hand. Like, dude, you have to. If someone's punching you, you have to get out of the fucking way.
Oh,
Nunez
is the complete package when it comes to punching people in the face and getting avoiding the punches. Jesus.
Yeah. One fight I would like to see is Nunez versus Holmes again.
Mm-hmm.
Because that did, I believe, ended in a decision, if I remember correctly. But. Like, just to see that. But Holmes is fighting for the 145 now, so I don't... And again, is that title actually going to continue after that one fight? I don't... No one knows.
It's weird, because it depends what happens Cyborg, I guess.
Yeah, Cyborg's gone for the next year and a bit anyways, so...
Oh, for sure. Unless you could prove somehow that it was tainted supplements or something. Even then, they still give out...
They still give out, it's a reduced sentence when it's not intentional, but it's still, like, you have to get the shit completely out of your system so you're this or that.
All right, so I'm going to dive into the next MMA events here in chronological order. Ryzen 4 happened in Japan. Pretty much as soon as Ronda Rousey got knocked out, they started broadcast in Japan. It was good timing. It was good timing because, you know, technically, that fight was scheduled for 5 rounds, and you know, I don't think anybody expected it to go 5 rounds.
Either way, it was not going 5 rounds.
Yeah.
But
all right, so I watched most of this event. I stayed up all night. Go through it here. The first fight of the night was pretty cool. Tenshin Nasukawa defeated Dylan Kawi Oligo. Yeah, sure. By a guillotine choke. Good way to start off the fight right here. But then the open weight Grand Prix semifinals were next. And Mirko Krokop defeated Boruto Kaito, which is he's a sumo wrestler who has four or five fights like that or something like that on his MMA record.
Yeah, something like that.
He doesn't have a lot. He pretty much got kneed in the gut, and he was like, oh, I can't hit it. And then he collapsed, and then it was done.
In the sternum or whatever, and then he collapsed. So he either got the wind knocked out of him or cracked his sternum.
You know, maybe the wind got knocked out of him. I think that he just felt that knee, and he ran away. He was like, okay, I'm done.
It's possible.
That's it. Because he seemed fine after the fight. He seemed fine.
Well, when he was walking out, he was going like this.
Yeah, but... yeah, he was doing that, but you know.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah.
And he's a sumo wrestler, so he's not really used to getting hit.
Used to getting, yeah.
Yeah. And whatever. Hey, it's a Japanese fight. I was kind of excited because, you know, it's Japan, but it was not a great fight. Let's just say that.
No.
And then Amir Aliakbari defeated Valentin Moldovsky in 10 minutes via decision. It was split. I didn't disagree with the decision. Amir pretty much dominated the first 5 minutes with his wrestling. And then the other round was a little bit closer, but it could have went either way. So either way, I was not opposed to this. Amir is a huge dude, and I think he's the only guy left in the whole competition that had a chance to beat Mirko anyways.
Yeah.
So, why not let him win? All right, next fight was between a bunch of Japanese fighters, Hayato Sakurai versus Wataru Sakura, TKO punches. I think I stopped watching here. I think I took a little bit of a break because I think a TKO was something I would remember.
I didn't watch any of this until the very end.
Okay, but the next fight, Jesus Christ, some shit went down here. Gabby Garcia defeated Yomiko Hata. And she's a 49-year-old professional wrestler turned MMA-ish fighter. And the actual fight, the only things to say is Yomiko at one point was going to run the ropes like a wrestler does.
Mm.
And then Gabby just fucking killed her while she was doing that. And that was the end of the fight. Like, it was so dumb. Like, Gabby should have maybe just let her do it because it's in Japan. It's like, yeah, we're running the ropes like it's a wrestling match. But, even if that didn't happen, fucking Gabby was so huge compared to Yomiko. The original fight that was scheduled here, too, was all crap anyways. So it was a crap fight.
Like, she's 49 years old, 160 pounds.
Mm-hmm. Compared to 220 pounds right now. She's 220 pounds right now. She was like 270 before this fight. She's going down in weight.
Her Ricky's saying 245.
Okay. I think the last fight that she weighed in Japan, she was 255, I think.
Okay.
Something like that. She's going down.
And, yeah.
Like, she doesn't want to be as big. She's going down.
So she's in her absolute, like, physical prime age.
Yes. Yes.
Fighting a 50-year-old woman that's
in Japan,
100 pounds lighter than her
in Japan. And she's Gabby Garcia, and she has what's her name in her corner? Cyborg is in her corner.
Oh, okay. That's where she gets her juice from.
Yeah, okay. So after the fight, this girl called Alpha Female. What's something Alpha Female? I forget what her first part is, but it's something Alpha Female. And she is also from Brazil. She was in TNA for like a few episodes. She's fought MMA before. She's a little bit bigger. She's not as big as Gabby Garcia. Oh, no, she's Russian. She's totally from Russia. She's Russian. She's a crazy Russian lady that's going to destroy Gabby Garcia next in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
So she came out after. It was like, whoa, who is this? She came out from the crowd. We don't know what's going on. And Gabby Garcia was like, I'm going to kick your ass too. But then Yomiko's corner lady was also challenging her to a fight. So you had this crazy Japanese lady challenging her to a fight. And this crazy Russian lady who's huge that showed up. Blonde lady. And she's all like, I'm going to challenge you to a fight too. It was all planned, obviously, but we'll see what happens with Gabby Garcia. She's either going to fight that other Japanese lady that she was originally supposed to fight, or she's going to fight the alpha female from Russia. Now, just do that fight. Why not? She came into the ring. She deserves it. Japan rules. I remember watching this fight. Dylan West got KO'd by Kazeomon Saiga. It's pretty one-sided, I felt. I thought Dylan West had a chance. And he did okay for like the first minute or so, but then he got fucking KO'd. So there you go. This next fight, though, was pretty entertaining. Andy Nguyen from America, but she's also Asian. Actually, you know what? I want to find out. Is she Japanese? Is she Japanese-American? Or is she... Because Nguyen, right? That's got to be Japanese. I don't know. I actually don't know. I was going to Google it, but it doesn't tell me. Anyways, so she came out. She had like a cowboy hat going on. She had the whole American gimmick going on. It was cool. Nobody really cheered her because she was facing Miyu Yamamoto, real Japanese girl. It's a really great fight. I loved everything about it. The intro was sweet. It was like a real wrestling introduction. It was really cool. Reminded me of Pride back in the day. But yeah, Andy Nguyen got an armbar. Late in the first round, and it was a good fight. I enjoyed all of it. The Japanese crowd might not have liked it as much as I did, because you know their local got beat. But hey, I would not mind seeing more of Andy Nguyen too. Not that she's super attractive or anything, but hey, she can kick some ass, and she's 3-3-0, which is not super amazing, but
okay. You're not pronouncing that name correctly.
Ah, whatever the hell. I hear everybody who has that name pronounces it different. Is it Nguyen? Nguyen?
Nguyen? I'm just trying to...
literally everybody that has that last name, I've heard it pronounced differently, so...
Nguyen.
Nguyen?
Nguyen? It should be Nguyen.
Her nickname is the Crasian.
Okay. Right. Should be pretty close to a Guyan.
Okay, sure. And then there's another female fight after this. Areta Kubota versus Hana Gujuan. And she fucking
body kick.
Kicked her in the stomach in the last round. It was an okay fight. It wasn't that great. Hideo Tokoro versus Asen Yamamoto. This was a crazy fight because Asen was actually doing really well on the feet, and then he just fucking got flipped over and gotten stuck in an armbar, and he lost. Like, Tokoro was clearly outmatched on the feet because right off the bat, he was getting owned, and then he got an armbar. It was a pretty good fight for what it was. And this was a really great fight. I guess you could argue this is the main event, but I guess the open weight Grand Prix is the main event. But
yeah.
Ron Gracie defeated Tatsuya Kawajiri. This is actually a fucking great fight. If you haven't seen it, I would suggest that you go look it up and go watch it because it's free. And you can go watch this pretty much anywhere, Ryzen 4. And yeah, it was fucking great. Tatsuya Kawajiri is also a really good ground fighter, so... It was a great matchup for Kron Gracie. And the first round was really close. I don't know who I would have given it to. I probably would have given it to Tatsuya because he was doing better on the feet in that first round. But then Kron pretty much just put on a clinic in the first 2 minutes of the second round. And he won. When they came back from the first round, Kron pretty much just owned the whole second round, and he got that rear naked choke on the ground. It's a good fight, man. Check this one out if you haven't seen it. And then Mirko Kokrop defeated Amir Ali Akbari pretty easy. KO punches in the first round, 2 minutes in. Yeah, Mirko had a pretty easy time in this whole tournament. He didn't need to fight the first round. He got a bye via the first round. And he was supposed to fight, who was it? Vanderlei Silva he was supposed to fight. And that got fucked up too. So, yeah, Mirko Kokrop got the easiest run that he could to this title. And he got a cool looking title. I'll give him that. All right. And then the last event that happened this week before we go on to the MMA Awards was... World Series of Fighting had an event on NBC, actually. and it was all right. Some stuff happened. So I'll just bring up the card on the screen here real quick if I can. Oh, yeah, there you go. All right. So the first thing that I'm going to say about this card is that they fucked up. They fucked up so hard because Yushin Okami versus Paul Bradley was originally on the preliminary card on NBC Sports Network, but then they moved it to proper NBC, right?
Oh, okay.
But I don't know what they did, because the fights on NBC, there's only one that lasted long. It was John Fitch and Jake Shields. Mm-hmm. It went the full 5 minutes. Yeah, it was pretty boring, grind fests, nothing really happened.
I'm actually quite surprised that Fitch won that, but...
Oh, he totally won it, too. It wasn't even close.
Yeah, well, I'm seeing the numbers, yeah. Like, it's...
It wasn't even close. Jake Shields, whenever he could get him to the ground, just stayed there. And didn't do shit. And we're just like, what is going on? And that was the whole fight. And whenever it went to the feet, John Fitch did okay. So it was like, I guess John Fitch won. But anyways, so yeah. So Yushin Okami did not air on the main card. So he got pushed to something called the post-eliminary card, which happened online after the NBC card.
Okay.
Yeah, so fucking imagine you watch UFC and you watch Ronda Rousey and then some fight got pushed to after it. Like, what the fuck is that? What a fuck up. Anyways, that's all I got to really say about the fuck ups for World Series that night, because it was pretty okay in terms of a card. I tried to watch the preliminaries on their website, but their feed has always been shitty, always, since the very beginning of World Series. They stream on livestream.com, which is an okay site. It's not Livestream's fault, but I don't know what they do with their live streams, because they probably use the same goddamn machines that they use to push it on television. So it should look as good as it does on TV online, but it doesn't ever. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the times, it just fucks up. And this was one of the nights that it fucked up. When it got to the NBC Sports Network card, if you were watching outside of the U.S., you were supposed to be able to watch it on their website, but you couldn't.
Mm.
So I had to go watch NBCSN feed somewhere, because I don't have Sports Network here. I do have NBC, though. Anyways, to talk about the preliminary card real quick, Smolenko Rama defeated Jake Hune via TKO punches in the second round. Don't have much to say about that one, to be honest. David Branch defeated Luis Taylor via submission rear naked choke in the fifth round, and 2 minutes in. This was a good fight. David Branch is really good. Luis Taylor gave him more trouble than I thought he would, but it was still pretty one-sided. Especially towards the end of the fight, David Branch just had more of a gas tank. And honestly, the rear naked choke just came because Luis Taylor was so tired that he was able to get him on the ground and get to the back and get the choke. So it was an okay fight. It wasn't super exciting. But man, I don't know what they did with this whole card, but they flip-flopped some shit around.
Yeah, there's some weird, like, why would that title fight be
not be the main event of the Sports Network card? Yeah, I know. But then they put Alenzakar versus Jared Rochalt, and this was fucking amazing. Jared Rochalt got KO'd to hell. This reminded me a little bit like Mike Pyle on Friday.
Mm.
Just like the one-punch thing. A little bit, but it wasn't as bad. It was not as bad. Jared Rochalt was able to get up not too long after. But yeah, it was one of those one-punch KOs where he was just limp and then hit really hard on the mat. It was a good fight. Rochalt, though, should probably stop fighting. He was fat when he was in the UFC, and he's still fat right now. So yeah, probably stop. And then, on NBC, New Year's Eve, 4 p.m., if on the East Coast, I guess this was 1 p.m. on the Pacific Coast. This was a fucking awesome fight night here that they had for World Series 34. Yeah, 34. Marlon Moraes defeated Jose Naldo Silva, TKO, a knee injury in the first round. the guy kind of just fell over and was like, "Oh, my knee," and then that was the end of the fight. But up to that,
popped his ACL or something,
I guess. But up to that point, Moraes was kind of dominating him. So, I don't know how the knee injury exactly happened, because seriously, he just kind of was just there, and then he stepped over and then fell over, and he was like, "Oh, my knee," and that was it. So I don't really think it was anything Moraes did specifically, but man, yeah, Moraes was all over him for those 2 minutes before that. So, and then John Fitch already talked a little bit about it. He defeated Jake Shields. It was a grind fest. It's like, again, this is a great fight to have on EBI. Put these two guys on EBI, fucking amazing, because they're gonna have to do something. They're going to go to OT and then they're going to fucking have to do it, because they're stuck in a position where they're going to have to get either tapped out or really fucking scramble and get out. It's one of the two is going to happen.
Right.
And in this fight, it was a lot of nothing. It's like, all right, we're going to be on the ground and maybe do something. No, we're just going to hold on to each other. And then, the main event was pretty good. But again, another weird ending here. Justin Gaethje always puts on a big performance. He's always a great fighter to watch. Luis Firmino just came out of nowhere, last second replacement. And he did really great. I would argue that he was probably winning the whole fight up until the point where the doctors stopped it, because his left eye shut closed. He could not see out of it, and they stopped it. So Justin Gaethje won via TKO. It was between breaks. Even
because it gives it 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm. So they were going into the fourth round. Again, it was a good fight. Sad for Luis, because he was slowing down a little bit, but I don't think he was completely done, and he was definitely like 100% he was definitely winning the first two rounds. The third round could have maybe went either way, but I would argue he won the third round too. So he won. So he was
eye,
winning. The,
so his optical, his eye bone, like the cheek or whatever, would have broke if it would have been that bad.
Perhaps.
Optical.
Is that what you're trying to say?
It's occipital. It's the name of that bone.
Yeah. Whatever that cheekbone that sticks out. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a great fight. Like, Luis really surprised me. I was not expecting this. Like, up to that point where they ended it, I thought he was winning, but he did get hit in the face a bunch, both of them.
Yeah.
So, it was a good fight.
If his eye swelled shut, then it likely would have been pretty
good
shot that did it.
Oh, Justin Gaethje, like, that's the thing about him. Like, you could put him in any car, like, if UFC, he is a free agent right now. He did not sign, and he is done. He is still the champion with World Series, and he is actively a free agent. So he could go to UFC, and he would be a good addition to put on UFC. Just fucking shove him on the TV prelims as the main event on any event, and people will fucking watch him because he's great. He might not be the best fighter, but he's always an entertaining fighter. All right.
Fights out of Denver, Colorado.
Let's go to the MMA Awards. Is that what we're doing right now?
Pat Barry. Yeah, sure.
All right, so the first thing we're going to start with, I guess, let's see. I kind of want, I didn't have any order to this, so Fight of the Year should probably be one of the last things we talk about.
Yeah, I would think so.
Let's just start with Surprise of the Year.
Okay.
I'm going to tease one that is not one of my winners. So one of my surprises for sure this year was The Rise of Doo-Ho Choi. He just came out of nowhere. Just this little scrappy South Korean. Hey, look at me. Fucking crazy. And he is. He is crazy. Mm-hmm. And I love that little guy.
He took a little too many shots, but yeah.
Well, in that last fight, sure.
Yeah, fair enough. But
think that was his fourth fight this year. It's four or three.
Was it fourth or third? I know he fought a fair number of times this year, but
Either way, that's one of my honorable mentions, and I guess I'll name another one here. Mickey Gall and Sage Northcutt happening. That is not my top surprise of the year, but man, that was so good. That was so good.
Yeah. Honorable mention for me would have to be the UFC sold for as much as it did. Just, yeah, like $4 billion. That's a lot of fucking money. That's a lot of money.
Yeah, for sure.
To the point that I think, what, 2 years ago, they had an offer for $600 million or something like that.
Well, so I'm just going to preface this right now. This is my winner.
Yeah.
But I have two winners. This is my winner for outside of the cage, like easily. Like, yeah. This is the top news story of the year. The UFC being sold, it kind of came out of nowhere. Like there was rumors of it, but for fucking $4 billion, that's ridiculous.
Yeah.
That's crazy. So,
and that wasn't even the top bid that they took. Some Chinese corporation did 4.2 billion.
By the end, I think it was the most expensive one, but I think that bid might have been earlier on and they rejected it.
Yeah, well, they rejected because there was some Chinese corporation thing, something, something. It wasn't someone they actually wanted to sell to.
All right. Do you want to go to your winner and then I'll go to mine?
My winner is Michael Bisping knocking Luke Rockhold the fuck out. Because who the fuck saw that happening? Not this guy. Like, I wasn't saying it was going to be just a horrible knockout of Bisping again, but I wasn't entirely expecting the complete 180 of the whole thing. So that surprised the fuck out of me.
Yeah. We're watching it right now at the bottom here, a little tiny window there. That totally surprised me too, but I don't think that's my surprise of the year. I'll go with a different pick from you. It was really close. This was my second top consideration for the year. But my winner this year is Stipe Miocic winning the heavyweight title. That's crazy to me. I never saw this coming out of nowhere.
The thing is, if you watch Stipe's fights, though, he kept getting better and better and better. He ran into Junior. That didn't work out so well for him, but he was given an opportunity to fight because Kane backed out or whatever. He took it, and dude, his boxing's pretty fucking solid.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no, for sure. Look, I'm not going to talk shit against his skills because he's pretty good. But, like, he got really lucky with the circumstances he got given.
Yes.
It's kind of like Michael Bisping got even luckier, my opinion. But I still think that this is the most shocking fight because Alistair Overeem, to me, was a bigger opponent than Rockhold. Like, I felt like Rockhold was defeatable.
You're just talking
or sorry, we're doomed. We're doomed. I'm saying we're doomed. I'm sorry. Yeah, we're doomed to me. At the time, I never saw that defeat coming. Never in a million years. It totally shocked me.
Oh, I'm just watching that. That was a horrible knockout. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I think that was the thing. We're doomed just took him lightly and he got destroyed. And I did not see that coming. Like, fuck. It's crazy. I love we're doomed. We're doomed gained my fucking respect since his days at fucking Strikeforce.
Yeah, but it's just, Stipe's counterpunching is really good. So if you're chasing him, you're likely going to take a pretty big shot. So, but yeah, it's Stipe, again, I guess we can maybe go, is on my honorable mentions for male fighter of the year.
Sure.
Just because, he beat Verdun and then he knocked the fuck out Overeem. So, like, he knocked out two good heavyweights.
Mm-hmm.
Like, two legitimate heavyweights, and he finished them. Like, how often do you actually get a champion that actually, like, straight out finishes his opponents?
In the heavyweight division, that's it, it happens.
I think Kane typically didn't finish people. Well, I guess he did finish Junior the third time, but that was just because Herb Dean saw enough and he had some hematoma on his head that was the size of a fucking ostrich egg.
Do you want to talk about the card of the year?
Yep. Let's do it.
The obvious pick is 205, right? That's like the obvious one. Everybody just goes, yeah, let's go with 205.
205 was the New York card. Yeah, no. Yeah.
That's the obvious pick.
Yeah. No, I did 206 was my favorite, the Toronto card.
For me, it's very hard. It's a very, very hard pick because if I go with my favorite card just based on how, like, the actual event, just showing up and watching it, it probably is 206, but 196 would be very close too, because 196 was fucking amazing. That's the card. That's the first Diaz and McGregor card.
Well, it was just the whole thing with Diaz coming in with 8 days notice and everything like that, and it turning into a 170 fight and all that was it did produce a lot, but that was the one fight. That's the way I saw it, not the entire card.
I like the whole card. I like that whole card.
I'm not saying the whole, but as a whole, I'm judging this as the whole card, and 106 was, or 206 was ridiculous as a whole card. Like three of those fights could be like fight of the year candidates.
Yeah.
And that's in one card.
Hey, look, I don't disagree with you, but look, 196 had Misha Tate and Holly Holm.
I know.
Aleira Latifi defeated Jan Vellante. Amanda Nunes defeated Valentina Shevchenko. That's a pretty good main event there. Diego Sanchez versus Jim Miller was on that card. Yeah. Like, again, the obvious pick is 205. Like, the obvious pick is 205. And I'm just going to go with the obvious pick.
Okay.
206 is really close. It's really close. Fuck, 206 was good, but it's just so fresh in my mind that I think I'm letting it get to me, and I don't want to let it get to me. 205, yeah, well, just overall, just, up and down from the beginning to the end, was just so good that
all of them are pretty damn good cards.
Yes.
Now, 206 was put out as the UFC's pick for.
206 would definitely be the card where I would be. It was my most surprising card of the year. But it was like I headed into that with no expectations, and holy shit!
Well, it had a lot of issues going into.
Yes, I talked so much shit about that card before. I was like, dude, I'm looking forward to the Fox event a million times more, and the next week with Michelle Waterson and Paige VanZant.
Yeah.
Like, I was looking forward to that a million times more, but then 206 happened, and holy shit.
Yeah, but think, like, because of everything that happened in New York, you got two of those fights just were, well, I guess Kennedy was supposed to fight, Rashad and Kennedy were supposed to fight in New York, and that didn't happen. Gaslam and Cowboy were supposed to fight in New York, and that didn't happen.
That fight is probably good that didn't happen anyways. We got two better fights out of it anyways.
Well, Kennedy looked like old man in that fight.
Well, Kennedy and Cowboy.
Cowboy looked fucking amazing.
Well, yeah, those two fights were fucking great.
Fucking amazing.
Those two, and if they would have been matched up against each other, they would have stopped each other. I think it's good that they didn't fight each other.
Well, just Brown and Donald, like, holy shit, those two, like, they're two people that go forward, and they fucking went forward. Just Brown needed to hold his fucking hand out. It's the head, he took like three or four of those head kicks, and just, and
like, I don't know, man, like, 205 I feel is just the better card on paper. 206 was the one that definitely you didn't have any expectations, and then you came out of it and you were just like, holy motherfucker, wow. That card was insane.
Pettis and Holloway, I expected a lot from that.
The thing, he missed weight, so my expectations went down a little bit.
Fair enough. But, like, just seeing that on paper, like, that sounds like an amazing fight on paper. And then Cowboy and Brown, man, that sounds like a good fucking fight on paper.
And Cormier
that happened, like, 2 weeks before, like, the Cormier fight and all that
Cormier
shit.
Cormier and Rumble, man. That would have been crazy.
Fucked a bunch of crap that happened on this card.
Yeah. All right. But, so let's go to submission of the year, I guess.
Sure.
Do you have any honorable mentions that you want to?
I guess Tate choking out Holm. Just being in the fifth round for the championship belt, just with minutes left or seconds left, just and home going to sleep, and just everything, the way that all worked out was really, like, amazing.
Okay, I have a feeling that this might be your winner, so I'm going to go with another honorable mention here. It's, where is it? Oh, God. I have this full fight.
And
no, wait.
Like,
man.
The Diaz choking out McGregor is interesting. Just the way it all happens, that he, like, all the hype and all the bullshit and the 8 days notice and coming off the fucking beach off with a martini or fucking, no, it wasn't martini, it was whatever the hell. He was drinking shit on some yacht or something like that, and then he's fighting 8 days later, and he ends up choking out McGregor. Whole situation was interesting.
I was going to mention Ferguson choking out Venata at Ultimate Fight Night 91. That was Venata's UFC debut, and he came in like a rocket. It was insane. He looked like he might have even beaten Ferguson, but then Ferguson came back. This was in like the second or third round, and then he choked him out. And this fight was fucking insane. Oh, here, I have it. Hey, who knew?
Says you do, but.
Oh, yeah, I totally have it, though. Yeah, no, this fight was insane. Like, when was this? In like, it must have been like in June or something, in the middle of the year. And, Ferguson, his opponent, got injured. Who was it? Such a long time ago, I don't remember. But anyways, Venata came out from Legacy FC, took this short fight, the short notice fight, and he delivered. He was confusing Ferguson with his kicks and his punches and his flurries, and this fight was so excellent. Ferguson was slipping all over the place, and he managed to get a choke. But that's the thing about all the chokes this year, is none of them were technically impressive. Most of the chokes this year for me were like surprises or like big time, like stakes, you know, like Conor McGregor. I guess Conor McGregor losing to Diaz. Like, that's not my winner, but the stakes were just so huge behind that fight that it was just so amazing when it happened, right?
Yeah. When
Diaz got that tap out, it was like, oh my God.
Again, you surprised, bitch. I wasn't all that surprised about it. It's just, and again, now apparently looking back at it or whatever, McGregor was just coming off a staph infection and shit, which is why he was saying he was so tired, and he got right back on, like, he didn't play bullshit of like going into the back closet for 6 months or whatever. He wanted another fight immediately because he didn't feel that he gave his best performance, and he came out and they put on another good show or whatever. But, it's shows a loss like that does show true colors,
right?
Because he was talking a lot of shit.
I'm gonna go to my winner here. You can see it on the screen right now. It's Francis Ngannou. He tore off Anthony Hamilton's arm off at Ultimate Fight Night 102, sorry. And it was just a really good fight. That's all I gotta say about it. Ngannou got freaking. This is heavyweights, is something you got to remember. Heavyweights. Mm. Guy got a Kimura from standing, throws him on the ground, and then gets the Kimura. Like,
yeah.
This is not something you see often in the heavyweights, so it's impressive. Out of all of the technical... All right, so we are back. And, there you go. Hey, my computer crashed only after 2 hours this week. So, you know, that's something. So we were into the surprises of the year? No, the submissions of the year, and I named Francis Ngannou versus Anthony Hamilton, where Ngannou tore his arm off with a Kimura as the winner. Blah, blah, blah. Man, she has an easy name, considering that she's Asian. You should be able to pronounce Watterson. Shh. It's still Watterson. Shh. Yeah, I want... Look, here's the thing. Anybody who's really attractive, just bank on that they're mixed. Just bank on it. Let's go like, you're super attractive. You must be mixed. Yes, I am. Bam. There you go. I knew it. Anyways, yeah. There you go. She choked out Watterson. Or is it Van Zandt? Mm-hmm. I've always thought that because Watterson's always been smaller anyways, so she has to use her skill. Mm-hmm.
He does overpower a lot of her opponents and then sits on top of them or whatever outside of back where she knocked her the fuck out. But yeah, so Watterson.
There you go.
Karate hottie.
So we have not agreed on one thing yet.
Mm.
Not one thing. We'll see. We'll see if that changes with the KO of the year. The thing about the KO of the year for me this year is that there were so goddamn many to pick from, unlike the submission of the year. So this was a hard category to pick from because you could have picked, you know, Michael Venom Page throwing a knee at Cyborg Santos. To be specific, Evangelista mm-hmm. Santos, sorry, which is her ex-husband, I suppose. So let's see. Where's that KO? I have it. It's right here. So this is the KO where he threw that Pokeball after the fight and stuff, and people got angry about it. But I only got, you know, people, I get why you get angry about it in retrospect, but at the time, he had no idea that he destroyed his face. So why would he care if he threw a Pokeball after or not? Because he didn't know at the time. But I'm sure if he knew that he fucking literally broke his skull, that he probably would not have thrown that Pokeball after. So yeah, that was an insane KO just because of the circumstances that happened after. Like, Santos literally had to stay in that country. I don't remember where they were, but he had to stay there because his fucking face was falling off.
But he couldn't get onto a plane because of the pressure change in the plane.
I don't want to spoil your winner here just in case I do it. Is it Lando? Is Lando your winner this year?
No.
Damn it. All right. Well, that's my winner. I might as well just unveil my winner right now. Just the way that he did it. The awards are so, how can I say this? Man, I had the perfect word. Subjective. There you go. Right? The awards are so subjective. You could fucking literally pick anything you want, right? For whatever reason. And the reason why I'm picking this KO is just the way he set it up, the way he kind of just like faked the other kick and just fucking spun around with that other leg and just, he never even saw it. It was just so smooth. The motion that he did for that KO to happen, everything about that KO was perfect. You could not have planned a better KO than that one. So that is why I'm giving Lando Venata my KO of the year. Just it was so smooth. That his spinning motion. It's just he didn't even try. It's like he wasn't even trying.
Another 206 fight.
Yep, 206 was amazing. 206 was great. I cannot complain about anything about 206 except maybe 205 was kind of better.
Yeah. Well, speaking of 205, my honorable mention would be McGregor knocking out Alves.
Yep.
Just Alves' face after he took that first left hand was like, what the fuck just hit me? And then he did it again, and then he did it again, and then he finally finished him.
Well, so I heard I heard people argue that this is a TKO, but I don't know how you could argue that because it was like a flush 4 fucking shots and he was down. And that was it. Like, he landed another shot on the ground.
It was a technical knockout. He wasn't knocked out cold, which is why it wasn't my winner.
Sure.
Like with yours, he was knocked out. Fuck, he was stiff. Like he was like, and my winner would be Dan Henderson over Hector Lombard, just because he was knocked out for like a good 3 minutes. Like he absolutely fucking destroyed him, and it was from such a weird. It was just like he was up and he just did that, and yeah, just Lombard.
That back elbow was pretty crazy.
Like, just the distance that it traveled to, the amount of damage it did, what like his elbow only moved like a foot and it nearly killed Lumber. Like what, how the fuck?
Except for the Lando KO this year, I think yeah. that this might be the only KO where I actually like got out of my seat and freaked out at.
Yeah.
And it wasn't because of the two fighters. It was only because of the actual thing that happened on the yeah. screen.
I jumped out when Bisping knocked him out.
Yeah, me too. But that was for a little bit of a different reason. Like,
yeah,
I was not expecting that, so I was like, "Holy shit!" With that Henderson, it was strictly for that KO. That's the only reason. Because of that KO,
and Lumber is a pretty good welterweight, or not welterweight, sorry, a middleweight. Mm-hmm. And for Dan Henderson to come down to middleweight and then just absolutely nearly kill a guy, like I don't, like just. If you're out unconscious for that long, you did some serious damage, which like a lot of people were bitching of why the hell Henderson got a title fight. Well, why did Bisping get a title fight?
Mm-hmm.
And once Bisping was the champion, he gets to like he needed to take back that loss. And I don't like that was a good fight between Henderson and Bisping. So I had no issue with that fight whatsoever for multiple reasons coming out, especially when you look at it from Bisping's point of view. But like Hector Lombard was just
so my winner was Lando Venata and your winner was Dan Henderson.
Yeah,
all right, cool. Some other honorable mentions, I guess we could throw out Nunes versus Ronda Rousey.
And again, I would call that somewhat of a TKO more so than a knockout. She wasn't actually out, but she would have been if the referee let it continue. Like, Holm knocked her the fuck out. Yes. Like, Holm knocked her the fuck out. That, like, she was going to get knocked the fuck out, and the referee said, maybe not. Because her hands were down, she was flopping, and just still taking punches in the face. So, it just not intelligently defending herself.
And then, but, another honorable mention I have here, which I heard through the MMA Hour, actually. This was actually the last Legacy FC fight event of the year, of the evers, actually, because they're done as Legacy FC. Mm. They're combining with Resurrection. So next year they're going to be called Legacy Fighting Alliance, I believe, instead of Legacy FC. Anyways, this is a slam KO from Gerald Harris. He's fought in UFC before, I believe. And Aaron Cobb came into this fight 50 pounds overweight. 50 pounds! And then this dude, Gerald Harris, picked him up, fucking slammed him down, and KO'd him with the slam.
What do you mean 50 pounds over? Like
he was 50 pounds overweight. He was literally 50 pounds over the weight class.
What was the weight class?
Light heavyweight, I guess. Because Gerald looks pretty big, too. He doesn't look heavyweight, but he's definitely light heavyweight.
I don't know what commission this was.
This was somewhere in the middle of America, so. I don't know. But yeah, hey, whatever. It ended in a sweet, sweet KO slam, so I can't complain about that. There are some other ones this year, too. Yair Rodriguez flying head kick KO over Andre Feely at UFC 197, which was pretty amazing. Mark Hunt killing Frank Mir.
This year. Yeah, that was one punch, looks at him, okay, now he's done. Mm-hmm, walk away.
Mm-hmm. Steve Bosse defeated James Tahuna with a deadly right hand at Ultimate Fight Night 85. Steve Bosse, Quebecer, Canadian, if you want to call him that. You know, pretty good showing from Steve Bosse. He was gonna debut. Oh, he did debut against Rampage, and he lost. But he came back with a roar after that fight, anyways. And you could call Paige Van Zandt's head kick against Beck Rollins a KO, but
pretty nice. Yeah, with that kind of, no,
that's kind of a TKO.
Was it? I'm pretty sure she was.
No, because she head kicked her, she fell over, and then she punched her a few other times on the ground.
Yeah,
it's not the head kick that KO'd her. She was not done. It's the punches on the ground that finished it.
Yeah, so but she still
it's was technically not that. That
it was her head bouncing off the ring that woke her up from the knockout. But, it's the referee's fault for not ending it at that point.
Semantics, though. That's not. That was a TKO. 100% a TKO. The thing about McGregor, dude, is that he landed that four punch combination, and yeah, sure, he landed another punch on the ground, but that's just because Herb Dean could run there fast enough to stop it.
Yeah, oh yeah, agreed. But I still don't think he was unconscious through any of that. It was just it was over. He was taking it was over.
Hey, so we suffered another crash there. I imagine that it's my GPU that's just getting overheated and crashing, and thus crashing my whole computer afterwards. But anyways, I believe it's the little videos that I was playing there that was causing all that. So I'm not going to do that during the fight of the year, which is... Should we do the fight of the year next, or should we go to the male and fighter... The fighters of the year? Okay, let's do fight of the year. Why not? I'm going to go with an honorable mention here. I already mentioned it earlier. Lando Venata versus Tony Ferguson at Ultimate Fight Night 91. That was a crazy fight. Ferguson got a late replacement there. I don't even remember who it was. I'm looking at it right now. I don't even know if I'm going to be able to find it in time. But yeah, Tony Ferguson, literally, like, I think it was 8 days that he got a notice here that Lando Venata from Legacy FC was coming in to wreck him. And Jesus Christ, he came out of nowhere. And he looked really good against Tony Ferguson. That's the scary thing. And then he came in in Toronto and just fucking wrecked Mac Desi's face right off with a fucking foot. So yeah, I love Lando. They were calling him Landon on that first event. That's how quick of a change he was. They didn't even know what his name was. So yeah, oh my god, what a story Lando Venata was in 2016. They get it close enough where I don't mind. I don't know, but okay, so here's the thing about Rogan, though. He's a Rogan. Yeah, you know? He says a bunch of stuff differently all the time, so who can fault him? He says Mitch great, and then he gets to, like, the ganyan. Like, you know, he says it really close all the time. He's really close. Like, the close. they're not that far off most of the time, but, you know. Here's the funny story. Do you ever go to, like, a store where they have the OLG machine? Well, I guess it's not OLG where you are, but, like, the lottery machines. And I don't know if it works the same in Alberta, but does it make the same noise? Does it make, like, when you cash in a check? And does it speak French there? Oh, okay, because here it speaks both, right? So it says winner, and it says gagnant, which is kind of like gagnant. So you just... there's a lot of people where I just say, do you know that machine? They're like, yeah. And do you know how it says, like, gagnant after winner? And they're like, oh, yeah, just say that, but just replace the with all. And then, like, oh, okay, it's the same thing. That's how I explain it to Canadian people. Or Ontarians, anyways. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I'll keep going with my a couple of honorable mentions here. Because I bet I know what your winner is. Is it obvious? Because there's two fights I was thinking about really hard. But, okay, well, Angela Lee and Mei Yamaguchi from ONE Championship was really good this year. That happened in, it was nearer to the end of the year, like August-ish, September-ish, around that time. Yeah, and what an amazing fight. I try to watch ONE Championship whenever I can. The thing about MMA is if I don't watch it live, usually I don't watch it. Usually, yes, yes. Mm-hmm. And it depends on the card, but like once this is one of the cards where I did manage to stay up. I think it depends on what country it's in Asia, but usually, you know, it airs here at like 2 a.m. to 5 a.m. depending on where exactly it is. And this fight I managed to stay up for it. And, fuck, man. They might not have the best caliber talent there, but they always manage to find two fighters that can fight and match up to each other. That it's always great fights. They always have good fights there, unless they have that American the wrestler from Bellator, Ben Askren. He's in ONE FC now. He's a champion there. You know, he's okay. He's not terrible. He's just, you know, he's like John Fitch and Shields. Yeah, they're okay. They're just, they always do the same stuff. So, anyways, that was an amazing fight. Go, Angela Lee has been the champion there for like a year and a half now-ish. And she's fucking amazing. Like, she might already have. Who knows? There's a few Asian girl fighters that are fucking amazing. Like Mei in this fight looked great, except for the third round. The third round, Angela Lee destroyed her. She put a clinic on of strikes. She got an armbar attempt in there. She got a triangle attempt in there. Like, that third round, that might have even been a 10-7 if you were really judging it that harshly. So I think, there's an American fighter there that says that they're making more money at ONE FC than they could have in UFC. It wasn't Ben Askren. Brendan Vera, maybe? But I don't think it was Brendan Vera. Brendan Vera either. Huh. I don't remember. And so here's my other honorable mention, and it might be your winner, but I doubt it if you're saying it's that obvious. So my other honorable mention is Cub Swanson versus Duho Choi at UFC 206. Right? That's an honorable mention, right? Oh, shit. What? All right. Well, there you go. Talk about it, because that's your winner. Yeah, okay, yes, I totally agree with you. So I watched both fights. I rewatched both fights just to make sure, because my winner is Robbie Lawler versus Carlos Condit. That was at the very, very, very beginning of the year. So I had to rewatch it. I didn't have a choice. I went to UFC Fight Pass. I typed in Robbie Lawler versus Carlos Condit and watched that shit. And that shit was fucking amazing. Rewatch that fight. sure. I think that's why I went with Robbie Lawler and Carlos Condit, because it was just five rounds of just pure goodness. Yes, yes. Me neither. I can't complain about your pick. All right, so let's go on to who to look forward to in 2016. You know, you could go with the obvious picks, you know, like Conor McGregor. I guess you could look forward to him in 2016.
Mighty Mouse, he is like, he held two fucking belts at the exact same time. Like, there's, what else can he do? What, he's going to go up to welterweight and take on Woodley? Like, how is he going to get higher? Like, he and the thing is, he's not probably going to fight until November, December. So what is he going to be doing in 17? That's a question.
Yeah.
Like, I just don't see
it. What if he fights like two or three times at the very end of the year?
Well, he could technically fight two, depending on how his wife's pregnancy works out and everything, when she's actually due. If she's due in July or August, he could fight then September and December. Like, that is perfectly possible, and especially the way he wants to fight, or the way he talks that he likes to fight all the time and this and that. It's perfectly plausible. But he's going to have a... Once the kid comes out, shit changes. Being a parent, shit changes. So he might not even want to come back after the kid's actually out. He has fucking money. He doesn't need money. He's got the fucking money. So he might not even fight in 2017. He might come back in 18 or something like that.
For me, for everybody that I thought though about on this list, I just went outside the box, to be honest.
Yeah.
There is some very obvious picks. Like, my most obvious one, to be honest, is Michelle Waterson.
Yeah.
And she's my winner.
Yeah.
Because I love her so much. But I probably should have started off with my honorable mentions. But there is a few other ones for sure that I want to mention after this. But Michelle Waterson, I've always loved her ever since I've seen her on MTV. I've always been a huge fan of hers. So, you know, it's not very surprising. But... just her two UFC fights have just been so surprising. Like, even her first fight, like, I think a lot of people were underestimating her. A lot of people were thinking maybe she would lose, maybe she would get
punched. Her size going up that 10 pounds, what that actually would do to her, because she was a fairly small atom weight coming up to straw weight. What was actually going to happen? Like, some of these girls in straw weight are actually like fucking 135, 140 pounds cutting down weight. Not to say the top ones are, but some of them are really big fucking girls, and
I can't disagree with all of the points. That's for sure.
Yeah,
I cannot disagree with all the points. But Michelle Waterson is just one of those people that, honestly, she's kind of like Ronda Rousey, but she actually fucking trains and she actually fucking puts the work into it, and she's with Rousey, camps that give a shit.
There you go. Rousey trains her at, like, look at what she looked like when she fought Hole, and then look at what she, like, she's obviously put time in.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, she looked great.
Yes.
Physically.
Last fight, she looked amazing.
But camp on what she's actually training, what is she actually doing day to day? Edmund's not doing the right things.
No, Edmund is screaming in the corner going like, clinch.
Yeah. Like, you can't clinch. Yeah, head movement. Well, there was no head movement whatsoever.
Oh, no. Oh, dude, I loved listening to that corner audio. Oh, it was so good. It was so good. Because I don't necessarily like Rousey, but I hate Edmund even more.
Yeah.
I've never liked Edmund ever. So, he's a huge dick. He was a huge dick to Rousey to begin with. So I don't even know why she's stuck around. Why did she? Because she likes dicks. Like what?
Maybe. Like,
he did not like her. He did not like her. The only reason he stuck onto her was for her popularity and for him to get forward into whatever career he has.
Yeah, but everyone knows who he is, and no one bought or drank his Kool-Aid of anything.
Nope.
So, well, I have some honorable mentions for
who to look for. I have a few. Oh, is that who you is that your winner too?
Oh yeah, Watterson.
Oh Jesus Christ!
She has the most likely possibilities of getting a title within 2017 from anyone that I can think of. Outside of me, like I have GSP as an honorable mention, just because what the fuck? Like he's talking like he wants to come back.
He's a wild card for sure.
Happening. Motherfucking BJ Penn is coming back next week or in 2 weeks or whatever.
Maybe I'm not looking forward to that because it's in 2 weeks or one, like a week and a half.
Well, after that fight, depending on what he looks like, what happens, like if he comes out and is BJ Penn from like,
oh dude, if he beats Yair Rodriguez, like that's impressive.
Fucking BJ Penn is motherfucking back with Jackson. This is going to be awesome. Let's fucking go.
I think he has a better shot at beating Yair Rodriguez than he did fucking beating, who was his last opponent? I was going to say it right when that sentence left my mouth and I totally forgot. was it Ferguson? No.
It's the wrong weight class. Because he's fighting at bantamweight.
It was right. Somebody in the middle there in that weight class, upper tier. And I was just like, man, that's...
No, wait, he's fighting at feather, not bantam. Okay, featherweight. Lamas? Was it Ricardo Lamas?
Yes.
I thought he was supposed to
fight. Yeah, Lamas. I think Lamas is a worse matchup for him.
Yes. Oh, Lamas is number three.
Yeah.
Like, that's ridiculous to be coming in on number... Even if you are BJ Penn.
I don't think that Yair Rodriguez is necessarily easy either for him.
No,
but,
no.
Yeah.
But it makes it's definitely more better. Sense.
Okay, so one of my honorable mentions here for sure, I think it's a sleeper too, is fucking Korean Zombie is back in February, yo.
Okay.
Chan Sung Jung.
Yeah.
He's back against oh man, he's got a fancy haircut. Don't tell me. Don't tell me because I want to figure this out. It's in February. I think it's on Fox. I want to say it's on Fox. Yeah, I'm just gonna look it up though. He's against... Oh, it doesn't even say it on his Wikipedia. Give me a break. Oh, Dennis Bermudez.
Bermudez, yeah, okay, yeah. He's the main event.
Yeah.
On
USC Fight Night 104, and that is...
they don't even have a fucking photo of him on this. What the
hell? That's on Fox Sports 1.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, no, so I'm looking forward to that.
Was he doing his... No, he's 29.
He's done. So he's done doing his Army service in Korea.
He's 29. He couldn't be doing Army service. You do your Army service at 18 or 21.
No, in Korea, I...
Was he an active soldier?
I think he did like some office work or something in the Army. I forget. Right. I don't think it was like active like on the field.
You do your mandatory... You have to do mandatory 1 year. Everyone has to do mandatory 1 year in South Korea.
I thought it was maybe 2 years.
So unless he was... No, it's 1 year, and you do it at either at 18 or 21.
Well, whatever it was, he did it when he was...
So he may have been an actual soldier in the Korean Army, which then he had to go back to active duty or something.
That's possible. But I thought...
Because he's 29, so he's much older than he would have been doing the mandatory.
I don't think he was doing active, like... But who knows? There's no, like, huge war going on right now, so... What is he doing? Just protecting the border?
In his summary, it has granite jaw.
In the summary, what? Granite jaw?
In the UFC fight history thing, it has like his skills or whatever.
Yeah.
Comes out granite as summary. Jaw. As granite jaw.
Sure.
Punching power, granite jaw, and aggressiveness. Just the way... It's not like... It's just granite jaw. Like, what the fuck?
Yeah, because I'm not sure how it works in South Korea. Because right here it says Jung announced in mid-October 2015 his intention to begin his stint for mandatory military service in his home country of South Korea. So...
But I was pretty sure it was either at 18 or 21.
Oh, no. Right here it says between the ages of 18 and 35.
Oh. Okay. Yeah.
And this applies from 1965 until now.
Yeah, okay.
Women are allowed to enroll since 2010. Progressive South Korea.
Allowed to enroll, so it's not mandatory for women.
No, it's not mandatory for women. No. It is not. So if we get some crazy South Korean bitch in this UFC, she can fight forevers.
Are there any South Korean women that are like...
Dude, there's got to be. There's got to be, but they're not in the UFC yet.
Yeah.
And if they are, they're American.
Okay, yeah. So, well, my last honorable mention is Max Holloway. That he's only... He's got the interim with whatever the fuck might... I don't know what the hell's going on with all that. Mm-hmm. But he's either going to be fighting for the actual featherweight or... might fight for the lightweight he was talking shit about again, but who the fuck knows what's actually going to happen there, because Aldo's talking about going up and fighting lightweight as well, so I that whole thing is a giant clusterfuck thanks to Conor McGregor defending his belt or doing anything. Just
featherweight, that's Korean Zombie. Imagine.
Yes.
Imagine. Yep. This is the year of Korean Zombie.
Yeah. No. Well, Holloway. Holloway. Like, that sounds pretty fucking fun. Now, I think he needs to. Like, I guess he does have a fight here in February.
Yes.
Bermuda. So then after
he could be fighting 3 or 4 times this year.
If he crushes Bermuda's, it might make sense to actually. Because, like, what's. Like, if Aldo goes up and fights lightweight, what the fuck's going to happen to this division? Obviously, Holloway is going to fight somebody. Why not Korean Zombie?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm not going to predict that he wins a title, but this is the year of Korean Zombie.
Even just getting to a title shot or something, like, because that's all I'm saying for Watterson is that she'll get a chance to fight Joanna.
Well, like I said, Michelle Watterson is the obvious pick, and I love her, and that's why I picked her, because she is the obvious pick, and I also love her, but man, watch out for Korean Zombie. That's my dark horse this year. But I also have a few other honorable mentions. Mickey Gall, who knows? Yeah. He could get killed. He could.
He definitely needs to improve his striking.
Oh, for sure. That's 100%. So,
we'll see where that goes. Like, potential, if he works really hard over the next, like, 8 to 10 months and it gets a fight or two and is able to do what he needs to do, just keep getting better and better and better, that he could get up into that top 10 by the end of the year pretty easily.
And then another one real quick is Cody Garbrandt. You know, that's self-explanatory. He went from unranked this year to fucking champion. So
yeah,
you got to be looking forward to whatever the hell he's going to be doing next here.
Yeah. Like, I'm just seeing this, like, looking for, he's just, like, I guess he already got the belt, is why I don't quite consider him. Because it's just to the point of, like, raising in rankings.
I totally get where you're coming from. But for me, I still consider him a little bit of an unknown, even though he won a title.
Yep.
Like the top five,
somebody there could still
beat him in the top
five. If he can defend his belt one or, like, 2 or 3 times, and then 2018 go up to featherweight, that would be pretty damn interesting.
We'll see.
I think he still needs to feather out or, like, work out a few little things. But, like, yeah, against Dominic Cruz, he looked fucking phenomenal. And then, again, there's even the fight against Mighty Mouse, that with whatever might happen with Mighty Mouse after his next 2 wins, what Mighty Mouse decides to do. Because it was always supposed to be Cruz. He wanted to get that win back against Cruz, and now Cruz ain't there, so... I don't really know what the hell he's
doing. He's also been talking about a rematch with Cruz. So, like, the thing about that division right now is who knows where it's going to go. It's it's entirely up to the UFC, right? It's entirely up to the UFC. I could see a Cruz rematch because that fight was really close.
Yeah. Now that actually might make sense of him fighting Cruz for the title shot, but again, Demetrius Johnson's has defended the belt 7 times. Like, Jesus fucking Christ.
That division, that one is even weirder, to be honest, right now.
Yeah, well, he's completely cleared out the fucking whole division.
And Tim Means was like the one hope. What's his name? It's not Tim Means. It's fucking
Tim Elliott.
Tim Elliott. Yeah.
He came in and that was an interesting fight. But after that first round, it was all fucking Mighty Mouse.
Oh, for sure. All right, so female fighter of the year. The thing about my fighters of the year is I didn't really have any.
Yeah, no, it's fairly slim pickings. It's slim pickings.
The female fighter of the year got confirmed for me this weekend when Amanda Nunes KO'd Ronda Rousey. Like, it's like, who else do you pick? You could go Joanna, I guess, but yeah. I went with Amanda. Like, that was just a stamp on it. She killed her.
Yep.
So that's it.
Yeah, and Nunes takes my pick for top woman in the UFC right now. Joanna's a close second, and then Watterson are then my two honorable mentions. Nunes just finishing, because Holmes still took a round and a half or whatever to finish her off. She finished her off in fucking 48 seconds. 48 seconds. Like, Jesus fucking Christ.
Yeah.
Like, she just destroyed, Holm put on a clinic. Nunes just fucking destroyed her, said, fuck you, you're nothing.
I think Holm wanted to put on that clinic right off the bat, but maybe she was a little bit hesitant because of, the aura of...
Yeah, fair enough.
...of Ronda Rousey. But
that's what happened, is she put on a clinic and was just going out and destroying her. Yeah. Nunes just said, fuck you.
I'm not doing anything. I'm just going to kill you right now.
Yeah, right. Exactly. that's that crazy Brazilian bitch is just... That's what she does.
A crazy lesbian bitch. Oh, man. I have no problem with lesbianism, by the way. I'm just saying. She's lesbian.
Yeah.
If any guys have any hopes of banging girl.
Her girlfriend is...
Back away, because her girlfriend might even kick your ass, too.
She is a UFC...
Nunes can do it on herself, but her girlfriend can also maybe do it. So
her girlfriend is she's... Alexei, right? Is it Grouse? Grouse? Is that?
I would tell you, but I don't remember.
Yeah. Okay. She is a ranked strawweight.
I've seen pictures of them, and she looked familiar, but I did not put any. I didn't look any of this up, to be honest with you.
But so her girlfriend would be able to beat the fuck out of you.
So
quite
this is the second known lesbian that Ronda Rousey has fought, and she got destroyed this time. Yeah, lesbians. You do it. Do it. Anyways. And then the male fighter of the year, I also thought was pretty obvious. I went with Conor McGregor.
Yeah. I won't quite say mine yet. I'll give off some honorable mentions. Max Holloway. Yoreiro Miro. Bisbing, Garbrandt makes a lot of sense from, and then Conor McGregor is an honorable mention.
Garbrandt is the only one that I would have maybe considered putting here instead of McGregor.
My fighter of the year is Donald Cerrone.
Yeah, sure.
Why? Because he went up to welterweight and finished four. Two of them being pretty fucking mass murderish type fucking welterweights. And then there was Cote, and then the other cowboy. That was essentially a joke. Yes. I don't know why that. But
that happened because the other guy was called Cowboy.
Yeah, pretty much. The way he finished Cote, the way he dropped Cote. Now, Cote's gotten older. Maybe his jaw is not what it used to be, but fuck. Story, Jesus fucking Christ, that was an insane combination that he put together to finish off Story. And then the Matt Brown fight, holy fuck. That was how that did not get a performance of the night tells you how good 206 was. And like, Jesus fucking Christ. And again, like, and he got beat down by a bigger guy and he still took those shots. He got knocked down once, but like, he still can't. It's just Brown didn't hold up his fucking arm and took too many head kicks, and just tells you, it doesn't, like, just as long as you got the skill, head kick is going to fuck you up. And Cerrone can throw a fucking head kick.
I'll do that on any other night. That KO against Brown would have won the KO of the night, but
yeah,
the Vanata, crazy spinning wheel kick KO that night.
Yep. And then Holloway fucking finishing off.
I wouldn't say that was a KO of the night, but maybe if you want to call it the fight of the night.
Well, no. That was performance of the night. I don't call it knockout of the night.
Sure.
But so, well, Holloway got performance of the night, and then Swanson and Choi got fight of the night, and then knockout of the
Lando
night.
Lando Vanana.
Yeah.
I don't see a KO being any better than that next year, to be honest. how clean it was, like, my god, like, that's scary. Like, that's the thing that you dream of at night, that you just wake up and you're just, whoa, holy crap. Like, I never want that to happen to me,
because
holy shit, that's superhuman shit right there. Like, if you can knock out fucking Mac Desi like that.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ.
And it was as well, as McDessie's a really good fucking fighter and
Canadian.
What the fuck?
Canadian Indian.
Well, is he Canadian?
Well, he's definitely Canadian. Let's see. McDessie leads out to believe that he's some kind of Indian.
No, he's from Halifax, Nova Scotia. Okay. I knew he fought out a TriStar. I did not know he was actually Canadian, though.
Well, I definitely knew that he was Canadian, but with a name like that, he's got... Oh, Lebanese. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Because that's... Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
But it's saying he was born in Halifax.
Oh, yeah. No, he's Canadian. From Halifax. He is Canadian through and through. 100%. I think he only speaks English. Nova Scotia, maybe he knows a little bit of French, but...
Yeah. Well, everyone in Canada knows a little bit of French. It's just how much.
Bonjour.
Yeah.
Hey, we all know that one. Woo!
Well, I have enough French to get through Montreal without looking like a complete dick.
Oh, if you're in Montreal, just speak in English.
I know. What are you doing? I know.
What are you doing? But if you're in Quebec, like, maybe attempt, but everybody's going
to
look at you
weird. I went to Tremblant, which isn't that far north of Montreal, and I met some real big dicks because my pronunciation wasn't proper.
Oh, yeah, no. Hey, dude. My French is pretty good. I've been speaking French my whole life. It's just, it's different from there. That dude's so different. He's white, but he's still weird with his French.
Yeah, he's just like, yeah. Like, I met two people in Tremblant that were, like, disgusted by my French and would not talk to me.
Or, well, no, the thing you oftenly get is like, hey, ça va? And then they just immediately fucking start talking English to you. And it's just like, dude, I was talking to you in French, you dickhead.
No, this woman, I don't think, knew any English. And like, I tried speaking French.
That happens too. That happens too.
And she was just really rude. And like, I'm obviously trying to speak French to you. I'm not being a dick of just like straight out just speaking English to you. Oh, it's Canada, so everyone speaks English, right? No, and that, like, she said like two words to me and then just wouldn't look to, like, we ended up getting another waiter.
You could be in Ottawa with somebody that also doesn't really speak French that much, and they'll try to talk French with you when you're trying. Like, Quebecers just don't give a fuck. Don't give a fuck about anything. If you're not from where they are from, well, okay. I'm gonna retake this. So, the generation of kids right now are very different than how Quebec is right now. So it's gonna transition slowly but surely, but like, it's still a lot like this. Like, if you're going into anywhere except Montreal, like, be prepared if you're not a French speaker. Yeah. It doesn't matter if you're white. It doesn't matter if you're black. That's like, it doesn't matter if you're Chinese.
My parents were planning to go to Quebec, Quebec.
Yeah.
And I told them not to because they don't speak French whatsoever. My parents. So I'm like, are you sure you want to do that? And they're like, yeah, it'll be fine. No, it wasn't.
Canada gets a reputation of being nice. And I got to tell you, like, rethink that, especially if you're going into the big cities. Out of the big cities, like, maybe Vancouver's the nicest, I guess. But, like, Toronto's an asshole. It does depend on what you mean
by big.
Toronto's an asshole. No, Toronto's pretty, like, it depends. It really depends.
Like,
You run into assholes more in Toronto than you do anywhere else, I think.
Now, what's your definition of an asshole, I guess? Or what do you mean by running into? Or what do you,
like just walking into, just walking around. And then running into somebody that just does something that you're just like, huh.
You're talking about crazy homeless people. The rat guy that lives down at
No, the homeless people, I give them a break. I'm like, I know, I expect that from them.
You know who Ratman is, right?
Not entirely.
No? Okay, well, he's at...
Is it the TMNT dude?
No. Well, no, this guy's like, he used to hang out in the same block all the time. So whenever I went down Toronto, he was always there. It was fucking creepy.
There's a dude that in Ottawa. He's called Peace Man.
And he always had rats with him. Like, he had rats in his backpack, and like, he would pet them and like,
There's a dude in TMNT called Ratman.
Okay.
He loves rats.
Okay.
That's his whole gimmick. Maybe they got him from Toronto lore.
Yeah. But yeah, the guy was fucking weird. But like, all in all, like, if you go into a store or go into a restaurant, of how people react to you.
Oh no, for sure. Like, look, I'm never gonna disagree about anything you say about Quebec, to be honest.
Like, when you're a customer and they're rude to you, there's just the what the fuck.
No, Quebec is fuck. I personally would never go there. The only place that I think is Montreal. That's Montreal. They'll go anywhere except Montreal. Because it's not worth it. Even Gatineau is right fucking there. It takes me 2 minutes by car to go across the fucking bridge.
You don't change the fucking name of it. It's fucking Hull.
It's Hull Island, okay? Or Ile de Hull, okay? Okay? It's totally different. Gatineau is everywhere. Like, that's the thing. Like, it's like Ottawa. Like, Hull was technically the biggest place.
Yeah, I know.
By population. But everything else is Gatineau. And then it just swallowed up everything. And it just became Gatineau. So, yeah. What can I tell you? It's still Hull. It's right there.
Yeah, I know. You
cross one bridge, it's right there. Yeah. It's... Man, I hate Quebec. I don't know if I said this before. It's not necessarily the people from Quebec. Like, a lot of the people from Quebec are actually cool. But a lot of the people from Quebec are racist, are dickheads, are... not tolerant of anything other than their own, but at the same time, they're also very nice about like healthcare there in Quebec, I feel, is very good. And the only reason it's very good is because they all agree to fucking pay more for it.
Mm.
And they're all like, we'll help each other out. We don't care if you're black, but don't come near me. And it's kind of funny, but it's true. And it's not even just black guys. It's anybody who doesn't speak French. The Quebecois French.
But they're not even speaking the right French.
No, they're speaking the Quebecois French, though. Yeah. That's their right French.
Because if they went to France, they'd be looked at like fucking morons. Oh.
I've spoken with a bunch of few French dudes, and like, I don't think I've ever spoke with a French lady. Now that I think about it, but like, I can barely understand. Well, okay, I understand them. It's the second I start talking to them, they're like, because they talk so fast.
Fast,
it's so fast. And I'm like, I understand you because you're articulate and you're pronunciating, and I totally understand you. But then when I start to talk to them, they're like, So with French people, I get it, because my French is just totally different. But with Quebecois, like, my French is really not that different, because a lot of my French comes from watching Quebec TV. So it's like, yeah, sure, my French is Ontario, but it's a lot of it is Quebecois too. So it's weird.
Yeah. My French comes from grade 4 and 5 elementary school. That's pretty much all I remember until I actually start talking to somebody in French, and then it all comes back to me. But
do you know, like, escape rooms? Like,
in what?
Like, you can, like, go to an escape room, and it's like a puzzle that you got to figure out to, like.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So it's like that. Okay. But in the 90s, when I was growing up, I watched a lot of Quebecois TV. And one of those shows was pretty much like an escape room. Like,
okay,
you got to figure out a way to escape this fucking castle. And, like, there's these puzzles and shit. And there's a lot of keys you got to get. And it's pretty cool. And, like, looking at the craze of those escape houses now, it's just like,
yeah,
man, that's like, that probably came from that show. Especially here, like, there's a lot of them.
Yeah,
here,
not a lot. In Toronto, there's quite a few of them.
Escape Manor. It's all the same company.
There's nothing here.
Mm-hmm.
There's mountains about 100 kilometers that way, and there's nothing else.
You guys have any bars that has, like, board games or video games or anything?
There,
like, that?
Might be, like, one or two.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not downtown. They're, like, out in the fucking northwest or something weird.
We have
some,
like,
weird, like, close to resident, like,
oh, like universities and stuff.
Yeah,
yeah. We had a few board game ones, but they closed. I know that there's still one close to downtown, and the video game one is still there. The video game one I've only been to once, and it was cool. There was Rock Band there. You could sit down, like, it was pretty much like, imagine a Boston Pizza, but there's a TV at every booth, and you can just get any system you want that they still have.
Yeah, no, I've been to places like that before, but I don't, to my knowledge, there's nothing here. Like, even, like, proper LAN cafes and shit like that, they don't even have here. Like, I've been to, like, places in BC that are, like, 120,000 people, and there's, like, 2 or 3 of them, but they don't have anything here. Like, they try to throw, there's a group of guys that try to throw LAN parties 3 times a year, and, like, 20 people come to them. This is out of a population of, like, 1 million people, 20 people come.
And not only that, like, it's like Calgary and Edmonton are so close. It's like, drive an hour. It's like, let's go.
No. Calgary and Edmonton are, like, 4 hours.
Four? What?
Yeah, 3.5. If you bomb it, you probably can do it in 3, but... It should be about 340. It's like Ottawa to Toronto.
All right. Well, I guess it depends where you live. Because me, where I live right now, I can go to Toronto downtown in about 3.5.
Yeah. So it'd be about that.
All right. Because for me, it would just be highway all the way.
Like, yeah, pretty much the same. And now I live on the very south end of Calgary, so it'd probably be a bit... Like, it would probably be 4 hours for me, but, like, it takes me, like, 35 minutes or 40 minutes to get to Calgary Airport.
Huh, I thought it was closer for some reason.
No. Red Deer's, like, right in the middle, so that would be, like, 1.5 hours, 2 hours-ish.
Man, that province looks pretty tiny when you look at it on a map, so...
Mm-hmm. It's long, but you can get across it fucking fast. But
I was thought there was like 2 hours between Calgary and Edmonton.
No, there's nothing.
You can see it the whole way, though.
No, all right. Well,
I'm just fucking around.
I'll no. Well, like driving from east to west, you can see Regina from 90 kilometers away.
Mm-hmm.
You,
I guess, because the Earth doesn't dip as much when you go
exactly. Like that's the thing. You should only technically be able to see about 25 kilometers, and then the curvature of the Earth blocks it off, and you can't see it. There's something fucked up with Saskatchewan.
No, I think. Isn't
and
it, if you go from east to west, isn't it like 74 kilometers? This is weather network bullshit that I'm remembering.
It could have been. It's something like that. It was some ridiculous number of
kilometers. Yeah, because if you have a perfectly flat area on the Earth that's going east to west, I'm pretty sure, like, let's say it's perfectly flat, there's no trees, there's nothing, and you look perfectly at the other end, and there's, like, something standing out over there, I think you can see 74 kilometers.
No. Normally, it's only 25-ish. Yeah. Like, I'm not sure if it's 25 exactly, but it's...
Because the Earth is a little bit more ovalish than it is roundish. So I'm pretty, like, east to west, anyways... I might be misremembering.
Well, east to west or west to east, it'd be the same.
Well, yeah. Well, I'm not talking about north to south, is what I'm saying.
Oh, okay. Well, it should only be about 25 kilometers ish.
Are you sure, man? Because,
like, if you're talking about, like, just normal curvature of the Earth, yeah.
Because I swear you see, like, lights in the sky from way further. Then, yeah, granted, that's a little bit more than 25, like, but like when it's like, but I'm thinking about Ontario, which is like all not flat.
So yeah, I don't know. Well, that's a different thing of that. Like, are you talking if you hill up or whatever is different than like you're talking just flat ground?
Mm-hmm. I have no idea. Because when there's no fog. Man, I might be misremembering this, but like when there's no fog, and they say visibility is at 100, I'm pretty sure it was like it's like 70 something kilometers. But
well, visibility would be is typically something like 30,000 feet.
Yeah, that they measure it from.
Well, no, but 30,000 feet would be vertical.
Yeah. So like this, like they measure it from like the CN Tower or some bullshit.
No, it would be from ground up 30,000 feet.
Oh, so like sea level something? What are you? What?
Yeah, it'd probably be something like sea level.
Okay.
30,000 right. feet up from okay. sea level or something.
Okay. So, yeah. All right. Hey, we finished talking about MMA. Did you realize that?
Yeah.
Yeah. So there you go. That's our awards. There's some MMA that happened this year.
Is there?
Yeah.
I did not.
And hopefully this year we do shows all year long because I've already been tracking what's happening this year. Like I've been keeping videos of everything that I've been being like, holy crap, this is pretty good. So what I'm going to do with those videos every month I collect is I'm going to collect them into a little playlist and then put them up on our YouTube channel. So there's going to be like KOs of the month. There's going to be submissions of the month. I don't know what else I can
put of the month.
Yeah, every of the month. And then at the end of the year, it's going to be easier for me to go like, oh, hey, look at all these fights. Look at everything. All right. That's going to be my submission of the year. And, you know, it's going to just make it way easier. Started doing that in 2007, I want to say. And we did not finish the year. So I was like, great. I have all these highlights of the first half of the year. And then we didn't finish the year, so hopefully this year is not like that. I'm gonna play this song in dedication of being fresh air. Oh my god, that. I'm gonna rewind that. So I'm playing this song in dedication of no fresh air is overrated this week. It's just gonna be our outro music this week. So yeah, hey, next week we'll be back with fresh air. Hopefully we'll have some video games stuff to talk about. Hey, I'm going to get some PS Plus this week. I have EB money, EB Games money, so why not? Why not just get it and play some Battlefield? So I'm going to play Battlefield this week, And hopefully some video game news happens. Because I just don't want to. I don't want to talk about Battlefield only. Steiner over there doesn't play Battlefield.
If you had it on PC, I might have gotten it.
You can go get Battlefield on the PlayStation. It was so cheap. It's so cheap. You could have gotten it.
I had Battlefield 4 when I got it for $5 or whatever that was.
Well, if it goes to $5, I'll let you know.
Mm.
Other than that, Megaswitcher.com. Go check that website out. I'll be posting this episode very shortly if you missed the beginning of it. You can go check out all our other shows. Fresh Air is Overrated. Removed from Play. The Standby Phase. All of that goodness. Go check it out. iTunes. YouTube.com/MegaswitcherTV. All of that. See ya.
See ya.